Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us this evening. Take your seats. The band is here. I got Chris Pickerton at Crashbox Customs on the slide whistle. I got Joe, a.k.a. Uncle Dolphin, on the harmonica. And I'm your host this evening. I'll be Bobby Skullface, and I'm here on the horn. And with that, we don't give a fuck about YouTube copyrights. Suck a dick. But I do think after 30 seconds they get you, though.
This will probably be the, you know, we're only on YouTube every other week for some reason. So yeah. This is probably that.
Well, I like the way that Twitch does it better. If you do have copyright music, they just mute that section. Like, they don't delete your thing. They don't mute the whole video. Like, they recognize where the song is, and they just mute that section.
Yeah. So, I like it. There are people that have podcasts on Spotify, and Spotify, it just circles it right in. It acts as if it's a stream. So, their algorithm picks up the song you play, and it just gives 15 cents of your whatever.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, that's money.
That's what should be happening anyway.
Yeah, that would be perfect. So with that, as you can tell, hopefully we are all together once again. Let's make a little bit of noise for that, goddammit. I miss you guys. It doesn't feel like it's the same talking about my dick when I can't see your eyes.
Just sitting here by yourself, talking to yourself about your dick.
It's also going to be the return of the Irregular Collectors. We're going to talk a little bit about the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle line.
Toys.
From the 88 film. And yeah, I think that's it. I don't have nothing really else to say. I'm happy to see you guys again. Happy to be at the table.
Absolutely.
Again.
Happy to be here. We got to get some settings straightened out.
Yeah, it's been a while. There's been some.
I can't hear myself in my headphones, but I hear you screaming at me. So
I think.
We'll get that sorted out.
I think that you might have one of Joe's and Joe might have one of yours.
What? Microphone?
Yeah. I think that might be how it, it's going down.
Hello.
With that, though, let me try to do that. How's that sound? Try now.
Hello, hello.
Yeah.
You had me turned down.
That's a taste. All right. So with that, I might have hit it for the slide whistle. I'm preparing for
that. That might have been what it was. Then.
Chris, you arrived early. You got your coffee first.
Yep.
Uncle Dolphin, how was your nerd week?
It's been 2 weeks, but like nothing happened last week because I was fucking working overtime. That's why I wasn't here.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking 10 days in a row.
Yeah.
Dude, I finished Unsolved Mysteries.
Did you?
Yeah,
oh, the new Netflix one.
Yeah, yep. You know, we kept saying, "I'm like, they're gonna have aliens."
How was
right?
it?
Why the? And Krista was like, as we were watching, like, why did they have aliens as an Unsolved Mysteries background? And I was like, they used to talk about aliens in the 80s because we believed in stuff. And then the last episode came on, and it was about aliens. I couldn't believe it.
How
many episodes?
I think
I
did hear that. It's like seven or eight, right? It's not many.
Ten? I don't know. Not many. But the last one was about. That was about aliens.
Good, perfect. They are definitely, if there's ever an unsolved mystery, aliens would be one.
Definitely. I mean, it was, I think, a nostalgia because, like, oh shit, it's an unsolved mystery talking about aliens. And two, is like, it's pretty compelling.
Mm-hmm.
There's like three different towns in the same, like, stretch of road that all reported shit to the police on the same night in the radio station, and they have like records of it.
I watched that one. I think I might have skipped around and just watched the ones that looked interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Was that one in like the 50s or 60s or
yeah,
something?
Exactly.
Yeah. I saw that one.
And there were people who are still alive at this point recounting the stories, and they corroborate.
Yeah,
stop,
I think that's right.
Corroborate.
Yeah, yeah,
with
it's
like
hard to say.
People that's never met in another town telling the same stories. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fucking interesting.
I have a question I was thinking about real quick, just to interrupt and throw some sauce in there. Is there any place on this earth where you're like, and I don't mean like an amusement park or like a Baby Gap or something, but is there any place on this earth where you're like, nah, I'm too old to go there. I've outaged that place.
Disneyland.
I mean,
the first time I went to Disneyland, I was too old for that shit.
So I think Disneyland is one of those weird things because I think there's a bracket you fall out of it. Like it's great from like 3 to like 11 and then trash from 13 to 19, and then it's great again from like 25 on.
Well, there's and
so
you bring
really
up,
weird.
You bring up a good point, but it's often been said that if you're going to take your kids to Disney when they're young, take them before they're like 4, because around that time they're like, that's a guy in a costume.
Right.
That's not Goofy or Mickey Mouse or whatever.
Right.
I mean, but I don't remember ever thinking that. I've always thought, even as a young child, that it's fucking people in costumes.
I was terrified by them. My mom has
you
a picture.
You thought they were real?
I don't know.
I think the first time I went, I thought they were real.
My mom has a picture. We lived in Orlando in the early 80s for like 2 years. Huh. And our neighbor worked at Disney. So we went to the point where it's like, you want to go to Disney? Okay. But like, I remember like just a picture of me with some dude in the Goofy suit, and I look just like, why am I having to do this?
There's a funny story, speaking of Disney real quick, that when I went to Disney World for the first time, I had this, like, I happened to stumble upon this grand experience where the characters were getting dressed in their character suits, right? And then they were coming out of this place, and they were supposed to catch this bus, and the bus was supposed to take them to the park. Well, they were obviously running behind schedule, and they had to be in character. So, like, they come running out of the room that they're supposed to be, like, their locker room, I guess, or whatever. They miss the bus. So now they're just stuck, like, at this, like, little resort spot. So it was just me and these characters until the next bus came, which was, like, 20 minutes. But it was just me hanging out with these characters. And, like, they, like, I have pictures of it from my childhood. Like, my dad took a picture. Like, they all, and they were, they were, like, they all acted like they ran out to the bus and, like, in a mess, and they're like, it's like a pile of Disney characters, and they're like, you know, and their hats are off, and they're all disheveled, and I'm just standing in the middle of them, like, you know, like a little special moment for a kid, you know what I mean?
That's cool.
That's really unique.
Yeah, it's cool
that nobody took their head off to just smoke a cigarette.
I'm on my break, kid.
I told you, that's what I love about, that's my cosplay shit, when I see Emperor Palpatine outside just busting down a fug.
When Mason used to miss the bus, I'd have to take him to school, and I would always play the entire time, however many times I had to play it. I Missed the Bus by Criss Cross, which is an atrocious song.
I told you Gary made his kid walk to school.
Yeah,
and was driving next to him. Yelling at him, and then people thought he was like some dude just harassing a kid and like called the cops. And you know what's funny, man, is so I follow, as you may or may not know, I'm a fan of entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
So I follow many independent models on Instagram that are, and you know what I mean? They're up and coming. They're trying to make a way for themselves, Joe. They have an OnlyFans available. And all of these women, you know, man, I got to be honest with you. I'm trying to give it the times, and I'm trying to be kind and polite, but I miss saying bitches. Like, I mean, it slips out every now and then, but like, I don't mean it necessarily in a derogatory way, but just like referring to like women, like, you know, isn't there like an acronym that somebody has coined that makes it okay? Like badass, independent,
BAPS,
you know, whatever. Anyway, I can tell from my Instagram feed, I'm too old for Miami. I've outaged Miami.
Oh, for sure.
There's nothing for me there.
No.
So when you said that, I was thinking like, how do I feel uncomfortable as an adult here? But yes, I'm not pretty enough to go.
Mm-hmm.
To Miami.
Yep.
I don't know that I ever need to go to Los Angeles either, to be honest.
No, I've been there.
I kind of want to go there for the touristy stuff.
Yeah, I do too. But like, I don't think I could live there. I just don't think I'm pretty enough.
I don't think I could live there. But like, I don't even feel like I can visit Miami. I feel like there's like a barrier at the front of the gate. Like it's like a giant. Like Miami's like one giant club, and the bouncer's outside with the clipboard. He's like, no, sorry, you're not on the list here.
Listen. Miami proper, I'm imagining you're talking about South Beach. You could probably go to Dade County and fit right in.
For sure.
Maybe,
you know what Miami smells like? It smells like the rest of Florida. It smells like Newports and alligator shit.
All right, I'm sorry, Joe. Continue.
Unsolved Mysteries. Titan Games Season 2 ended this past week.
I didn't see the finale.
I won't spoil it for you, but love it. It's quite enjoyable.
Did the redneck guy win? That's just...
No.
Okay.
The firefighter won.
Okay.
They were neck and neck, but yeah. But I'm happy because those two are my two favorites of the whole thing. I could care less either one of them when they both made it to the finals. That's...
Jody, are you a fan of the CrossFit Games? Have you watched that before?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I know of... They're not called CrossFit Games anymore.
Right, because, yes. The Reebok Strong People competition or whatever
they're
calling.
Yeah, I watch it for funsies and... Well,
I just
and that
there's a little known fact about the CrossFit Games when it was CrossFit. that like at the end, the finish line, if when you rang the bell, you did the thing, whatever, said it was in, then drop down one grilled piece of chicken and one small Tupperware container full of broccoli. Because I, I feel like everybody I know that does CrossFit, I see a picture from their fucking Instagram once a week of like just a kitchen full of fucking little Tupperwares
meal prep.
Yeah, with like one chicken and one fucking serving of broccoli. And it's always those two things. And what I'm going to laugh
some rice.
When I'm over here eating pizza and smoking and fucking living my best life, and they all die of fucking cancer from fucking warming up that Tupperware in the goddamn microwave, and I'm over here fucking living it up.
Bodybuilders and CrossFit people.
I was asking that, Joe. Is that skill set, the CrossFit skill set, which I know is vastly different, but competitive, do you think that translates directly to
no,
the Tiger
directly.
King?
That's why it wasn't fair. Like the one of the girls that competed, they did not, which it's fine that that she is a CrossFit, like professional CrossFit competitor. Mm-hmm. I think she retired, but like she became like a commentator, like so she's well known in the CrossFit games, but they didn't mention that shit at all, and I'm like, that's
really
wrong
and weird.
Yeah, they mentioned she runs a wine winery.
Probably don't want to give them the rub.
Yeah, I'm more impressed by the winery, to be honest with you.
But like, it's pertinent information.
Yeah, no,
like, this winemaker is doing fucking amazing. No, this CrossFitter is doing fucking amazing.
Bobby's gonna like this one. You should see that bitch stomp a grape.
That's what I'm talking
about.
Bring
man.
It back. Bring it back, and we're just giving her credit.
It is.
Yeah, I didn't like any of the finalists of the ladies. Like, there's two ladies that I really liked, and they both got eliminated. Like a little while ago. But no, I enjoyed it. I really liked the country guy.
Yeah,
like genuinely, I was surprised,
dude. People laugh. I mean, you say somebody's country strong.
Oh, that's just real.
It's. I mean, if you're out there slanging hay bales and you know working your ass off, that's a different kind of scrimp.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah.
That's that dude that just moves a refrigerator one day from like somehow you find yourself in a circumstance where he's got to move a refrigerator and he just handles it by himself. You're like, well, I can help.
No, man, you're gonna mess up my geometry. Just stand back.
he did not look like a fucking athlete. He looked like he could be strong.
Right.
Yeah.
Like
he
carrying
extra
so weight.
It was so quick.
He was scrambling like a fucking hamster. Like, I could not believe
it. It was good shit.
It's fun. Watch the finals. Like, even you know
yeah,
who won.
It's
like,
on Hulu or something. I'll check it out.
It's fucking great. I bought a car.
What'd you get?
A Subaru Impreza.
You're not a car guy, are you?
No.
Like,
I like cars.
Have you ever been? Cool. I don't think either of you guys have ever been like super car, like into the car culture and nerds about cars.
No,
something.
I was just happy that I had I was able to have a Chrysler New Yorker, 89 Chrysler New Yorker when I started driving, and that shit looked mobbed up.
Oh,
I was going to throw you in the back of the trunk immediately.
For sure. So why did you pick the Chrysler Impreza, but the Subaru? Why'd you go with that?
It would mean 0%. Interest. So, right now, there's some dealers and some cars is like 0%.
So it was a completely financial decision.
No, there was multiple models, but like right. that was the first thing. I was like, well, maybe I should look into cars because my car, you know how much I drive.
Yeah.
Like they're getting to be 90,000 miles. Like,
yeah.
Getting towards 100. So I was like, I should fucking replace this.
Did you trade in your other one?
Yeah.
Did they give you like a decent?
3,000.
Oh my
gosh, that's really good.
Wow, is it? I don't know.
It is. Okay. I have had that car for 8 years. It's close to 100.
I didn't know the car
miles.
Was 8 years old.
Yeah, like I mean, I take care of it. I don't do anything crazy. I don't smoke or, yeah, but it's the first time I got all the colors I want. Like I love it. It's not a great car. It's like a medium car. It's new, so it makes it good. But it's black on the outside, and the interior is black and red. The
nice.
Stitching is red.
Oh, nice.
With red lights, and that's. Fucking, those are my colors.
Yeah,
there you go.
I've never had a car because I've always settled because it is a financial thing. I'm not gonna pay the fucking extra whatever money to get a black car. So
yeah, no, I'm in the same boat. I drive a fucking Civic, and purely for gas mileage.
Yeah, I mean, I like those cars too.
Yeah, but like, I mean, they're fine.
Yeah, they're fine, but it's not something like something to brag about.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, I loved having my first 300 that I had was that somebody wrapped me around a fucking light pole in. That was the only car I ever bought in my life that I felt proud of.
Yeah.
You know, that shit felt good getting out of it. It had chrome wheels on it. It had like, it had a Boston system in it. Like it fucking felt money. And now I'm in the fucking, Civic. I don't even know the Civic has leather seats.
It doesn't.
Yeah, there you go. So
how do you not know that?
I think I outgrew it. Like, I used to really care about the emission cars. Like, right when I graduated pharmacy school, I got a BMW, and it was great. It was a fucking amazing car, best car I ever had. But as soon as the warranty ran out, I traded it in for the Nissan. Yeah. Because, like, it was it's free. 335. Yeah, nice. Turbo and everything. But, like, the maintenance is free. You can take the car in the shop anytime you want. No calls ahead needed. And they'll give you a loaner and do whatever you want with the car. But as soon as that warranty is over, you pay for everything. So, like, a tire is like a fucking $1,000. I'm like, nah. The day it ran out, I fucking trade that bitch in.
Look, I gotta be honest with everybody. Joe's sitting here talking, and all I can think about is how much like Liu Kang looks like, because he's got his hair.
I'm doing Liu Kang.
he's got his hair growing
and
out.
He's jacked to the moon.
And it grows naturally, like in a look mullet shape. And
It's my COVID mullet, because I didn't get this haircut. I just stopped cutting my hair.
Right.
So it's short in the front and long in the back.
Dude, it's so funny, man. He's like the zombie version in the back and the live version in the front.
Nobody in my house has had a haircut, except for myself, obviously,
right.
since COVID. So Kelly, bless her heart, her hair just literally has a mind of its own. It's bad shit crazy. She's going tomorrow to get it cut. And I think Charlie's hair, he's... It's long and it's fluffy and it's got these spiral curls like down the sides and
like Hasidic
Jew curls. Yeah, Mason actually wears a top knot now. With his sideburns.
Wow. Yeah. Just because of how Liu Kang it is, I feel like when you go to a place like buy a car, you should just throw out video game references like the whole time, like. here you are, Mr. Joe. We got your car all ready for you, and just perfect.
Oh, that car is toasty. Oh my
god. You should pay with a bag of gold coin. Just throw it on the table. This should be sufficient.
Where are you from? China.
I'm a Street Fighter. Yes.
It all works. I think they actually say Hong Kong in there though, don't they?
Oh, they might.
With Fei Long, he's from Hong Kong. But like, the original is only the 8.
Right.
But no.
Continue. I'm sorry.
I know, so that it's nice to have a new car.
Mm-hmm.
I feel safe, and having a car to actually enjoy to like drive in. It hasn't been 8 years since I enjoyed driving in a car.
Wow.
Every time I pull into work, I got my music up, and they're just looking at it, shaking their head like, you got to do something about the sound quality of that fucking Civic, because it's just
like,
the whole
like this.
It just sounds like you put two rocks in a tin can.
Man, I used to be into audio systems and stuff, and that's the worst. I had a 64 Impala with
big body.
Yeah, two tins and a two tins and a huge box in the I think it's called a third. I don't know. The box was made with all these baffles in it. It sounded like 215s, but there was still enough room in the back to put four bodies.
Mm.
But that thing rattled like a jewelry store in an avalanche.
And fucking license plate.
It says all the trim.
Everything. Yeah.
All the.
No, you have to get like, it's a lot of work to get those things like solid. You have to like put padding around the doors and fucking everything.
Dynamat.
Yeah, exactly.
What do you think about Wet Ass Pussy by Cardi B and
I finally listened to it.
And Megan Thee Stallion.
I have no idea what that is, but I like Wet Ass Pussy.
I'm not gonna listen to that with a group of guys. Actually, we could if you wanted to stop listening. It's actually that's the first Cardi B song I've ever heard that I actually like, because she is so annoying to me.
I'm gonna stop it real quick and get Joe's hot take on it. So,
I'm confused. Cause like,
is it the ding?
No, good writer, I guess. I like it's no denying that shit. But like, I'm confused because I like all the stuff she was talking about.
Uh-huh.
But hearing her say it, I'm like, ugh, I don't want to touch you. Don't be in the same room as me.
No.
So, who wrote that song?
I don't know.
Because I don't think I'm. I knew who Megan Thee Stallion is, and I think that might have been the first time I've heard her rap.
Mm-hmm.
It's whatever, it's fine, but I don't see Cardi B sitting down and writing anything. Somebody's saying
so artistic.
Well, she's
I'll married, tell you this:
married
if
to one of your amigos guys,
not one of my amigos. Okay, no, the amigos aren't my amigos. You know what I mean? But I think if she didn't write it, which she may not have. I think that I'll say this. I think that she definitely has a team with her for every creative endeavor that she engages in, because she's a big money artist. But I think whoever wrote that line about the dangly thing in the back of your throat definitely tapped into her psyche. Because that seems like in tune with her.
Some shit she would say.
Yes.
What do you give it on a grade scale? A, B, C, D, E, or F?
I don't know. Like, B, I guess?
So I'd probably give it a C. And I don't like it. I would never listen to it.
I don't like it. I don't. But like, you can't deny it's got a beat. It's compelling, I guess.
I think it's the fact of like how shocking it is that makes me interested in it. Mm. You know, like, oh, yeah, I'm okay with pushing the boundaries on everything pretty much.
I think that's what gives it the B for me. Because if it was about anything else, I'm like, whatever. I don't care about it.
Right, right. I mean, she said she was going to spell her name while she was on top of it. Mm. I hadn't considered that. all right, continue. I'm sorry.
I told you we're having anime night every Saturday night with our Discord people.
Yes.
So we finished the Berserk trilogy. Fucking awesome. It holds up with time. Watch Howl's Moving Castle this past Saturday. It's like, a lot of people love it. It's like one of their favorite Ghibli movies. But like, I like it fine, but I think it's kind of overrated, personally. But I think Christian Bale did a great job voicing the main actor, main character.
I didn't even know.
Watched Splice last night, or 2 nights ago. It's an old...
I remember it coming out, and I never watched it.
I mean, it's a horror, I guess, sci-fi horror movie. I quite enjoyed it. It was better than I thought. But I wanted to see it when it came out. I don't even remember how long ago, but I just never got around to it. But now it's on Netflix, I think.
Okay.
I think that's what I like about Netflix is like they rotate in stuff even when it's old, so it's like new again. What else? I was on Dante's podcast last night.
Off the mats. Yeah, shout out to Dante. He's got a new podcast out there, Off the Mats.
Had a great fucking time. We scheduled it for like an hour and a half. We ended up talking for like two and a half hours.
Yeah, that's how it is.
I missed that dude.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, so
he's welcome to come over now for me anyway.
I don't know if he. It's good for him, but like, yeah, we all got to get together after this.
Yeah.
This fucking thing.
Yeah.
All right, everybody, just go catch that shit. Get good.
It was funny. I was talking to Phil via text, and he was like, man, I'm looking forward to getting together again and all that. And I was like, well, shit, man, I'll be honest with you. I don't give a fuck now because I've had it. You can come on over and hang out. And then he was like, yeah, man, crazy times. Just like, I was like, it's okay. Wow. I get the vibes. There's a little bit of COVID on that coffee table. Be careful.
Yeah, I was cool to come over a while back, but I was like, I don't want me get your kid sick.
Right.
But since you got your kid sick already,
right. Like, hey, what are you gonna do in the bottom of that detolf? Oh, it's already COVID in there, man. Don't worry about this. It's my COVID.
It's just sample. It's a display of COVID. And yeah, it's still twitching. Like it's good. Like,
it's a muscle thing, man. Mike Tyson used to do that shit before a fight. You remember that? Like, he would walk. He was like.
I you don't want to fuck with that dude.
Fuck no, dude. That dude still scares me. Even though he doesn't look the same, he still scares me.
Have you seen him throw a punch lately?
He's still got it.
He's supposed to be fighting Roy Jones Jr., but they can't try to knock each other out or something.
Yeah, I read about that. He also he did a podcast and decked some dude on the podcast.
I heard that.
I didn't hear about that.
He did a podcast.
I don't know what the story is. Disrespected his friend or something like that.
Pac. So he had WAC 300. You familiar?
I've heard the
name. Andre 3000. Are they like?
No, not related.
Okay.
All right. Different tenth.
But probably a lot better than Andre is.
Oh, without a doubt. I'm not sure. I'm not totally convinced that he's from this planet.
Who is?
Andre.
I don't think he is.
But WAC 300 is a manager, and he manages the game. And
Okay. He's not an artist. He's a manager.
Correct.
With a horrible name.
Correct. And he also manages Blueface. He's like a newer guy.
It's like one of the people in Blue Man Group?
He's not good, Blueface, in my opinion. But anyway, long story short, too late. He is also a gangster of sorts, and he was on this podcast with Mike Tyson, and Mike Tyson started, like, apparently he said something disrespectful about Tupac at some interview or whatever, and Mike brings it up, and you can see him if you watch it, because there's YouTube of it. I'm not sure if it's been taken down now, but when it first came up, you can see that dude unravel in real time.
Oh, like the WAC guy?
No.
Oh,
Mike
Tyson?
Yeah, like lose his
sanity, lose control of his mental state. Like he's just sitting across from the dude, and he's just like, yeah, you know, recently you were on such and such, and you brought up that thing about Tupac. And he's like, yeah, I was on the such and such show. And he's like, yeah, man, I got to tell you, man, I wasn't feeling that. I was friends with that dude, and you know, he was a friend of mine. And like he just started just raising and raising and raising, and then before you knew it, he just swung across the table and knocked this dude the fuck out.
Like, wow!
Yeah,
that's a friend that got your back.
Yeah, just fucking fighting for you to like 20 years after you died.
Mm. I mean, obviously, it means something to him. Like, yeah. It was getting emotional.
Yeah,
because like he's been chill for a long time. Yeah, like, he's been talking about like being calm and fucking growing weed and
he's got a
So I mean, it must be something.
Like I said, you can visually see him begin like the thread come off the spool.
I wonder what his. You think he's been smart with his money, or do you think it's gone? I mean, he had a tiger for at one point.
But he's like, well, I was an idiot. I had a tiger. What the fuck was up with that shit?
I don't know.
I mean, he has a business now.
And that's maybe he invested well. And I know
it depends on the people you got in your corner, man. Always like.
That's it. Like, I don't know, you know, Don King was involved from a fight standpoint. Was he in his pocket?
Right.
Too?
Yeah, exactly. Like,
Mike, I'm going to take 75% of your money.
That other dude that he used to call like his dad or whatever, like mm-hmm. that old white dude, like that dude had
Pops.
Pops.
I don't know. Was it really Pops?
It was something like that.
Okay.
That was, but that's like what he used to call him. That's what he used to call him. But like that dude loved Tyson. Like they had a genuine love for one another. But he died at some point, and I don't know, you know, where that shit went. He might even replace him with Don King at some point. I can't remember. Don't get me lying.
I think he's doing well now. He probably had a dark period, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But I think
I'd love to see it, man.
Yeah. I think
I love Mike Tyson. He's a fucking icon to me. But my childhood and in Black Trunks, man, that shit still gives me the creeps.
He's got a video game. I mean, he's a legend.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I was saying, Twitch.
Off the mats.
Off the mats, and then Twitch is going great. Oh, we do it like 4 or 5 times a week. Well, I'm on it like 3 times. I'm only on the fitness stream. But she does a lot of gaming. She has a little network of like other streamers now, like she broadcasting games with. And she's getting a good following.
Nice.
And she's starting to...
I had somebody hit me up just recently to try to find her on Twitch. And I said I wasn't sure, but I gave her the Twitter handle.
Yeah. It should be on all her social medias.
Yeah.
But yeah, so she cosplayed at, you know the girl that bought the...
Well, I saw the GIF of that.
Yeah.
So let me tell you something, and I don't mean any disrespect. I thought it was a dude at first.
She's jacked.
It's crazy.
We're cutting and fucking, we're getting...
Okay, when you sent it, I thought it was a dude in that outfit, and I was like, what? Come on, Joe. And I was like, oh my God, I felt like I wanted to apologize, but then I had to explain it all in text.
No, it's fine. we're doing pull day, so we're doing hella fucking pull ups and shit. So the lats are pumping.
Uh-huh.
She got that fucking triangle up,
upside
down triangle.
Yeah, 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 for sure.
But that's the character, you know, that I.
Yeah. The one that you got all the knockoff. I'm sorry. The fourth party. Yeah,
third party. I wish that was fourth party. That's not even a first party.
I'm just kidding. The third party statues.
Yeah, I wish that was first party or fourth party. I don't give a fuck. But like, so I can't get off that shit. Like, I've just been jerking off to her. I haven't been watching porn. I've just been jerking off to my wife cosplaying as this bitch.
To GIFs of it, or having her like in the house, like walking around and like just
and all of it in my head right in picture form. Okay, GIFs. I pull up the VOD, the Twitch recording. I watched that shit.
It's unfair because I know that Kelly listens to this. I was about to ask you, have you ever jerked off to a picture of your wife or something? Like,
absolutely.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
No doubt. I wish you'd send me more. Hey, listen, I used to be on the road a lot, bro.
Well, no, for real. I mean, I've done the same thing, but it's a lot more
when you were dating, definitely, right?
I don't know, man. I don't know because, like, when
Bobby and Laura dating, the flip phone pictures weren't that great.
But not only that, but like.
You had to print it out on a dot matrix.
I mean, like, there's a difference. I mean, when I was dating my wife, she was a girl.
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference between a girl and a woman,
mm-hmm.
you know. And when she started really becoming a woman, and then it was like, you know, ever since I'm like, I can't wait to like dress her up like a fucking quarter scale statue.
My girl dressed herself as quarter scale statue, but like I don't know if I can ever have her not wear that outfit or to start with ever again.
Right.
Yeah. Well, that's pretty awesome. That you know, that's I think relationship perfection.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Like. My fictional waifu and my real life wife is the same person now.
There you go.
So
them hands are good. Does she wear gloves when she weightlifts?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, Because as strong as she's getting, I wonder how you feel about them tough hands grabbing your shoulders during the peg session.
Hands up.
Dude, that's a lot of weird muscle guys out there.
Oh, there's no. Oh, no. Look, there's a lot of weird dude. But some chicks step on turtles and shit. Like, you know, there's you don't gotta explain anything.
Like people would just pop up on Twitch because it's a live stream. They're like, show me your biceps. I'm like, or like, show me your abs. It's just like flex for me.
Like, squeeze a hummingbird.
Yeah, drop a couple bucks in that super chat or whatever.
That's what we say, and sometimes they do. Yeah. But I didn't know there were that many fucking muscle fetish guys out there, because like it's not, I guess, the norm. Like most guys are like, I don't want my lady to be too muscular,
right? And I it's like a fetish, right? Like, I mean, you know what I mean? Like, any, like I would say all the most fetishes are abnormal.
I don't think
a deviation.
I don't really
a deviation from the mainstream.
As long as it's adults involved, I don't think anything strange.
Like nobody says I got a fetish for like butt naked in the bed, married.
Missionary
position
under the covers
with the lights off.
The covers.
You know, nobody says I got a fetish for that.
But having fetish, well, I guess fetish aren't fetishes anymore when it became normalized. I think like anal used to be a fetish, because when I used to be really into assholes, like people were like, "You're weird." I'm like, "Nah, man, assholes are great." And now like, everyone's like, "Yeah, assholes are great. Eat them up."
Look, I don't think we're quite there yet.
Eating ass is normal now, pretty much.
It's more normal than when we were kids, for sure.
I was the only one eating ass.
It's not normal like a French kiss, Joe.
It's at least third base.
It's pretty.
I think that
the rap group.
But I don't know if it's fetish. It's talked about in mainstream media.
Correct.
Is it still a fetish?
I think so. I think it's still in the fetish category. I think if you got your own tab.
The soda.
I think if you got your own tab on the Pornhub, it's a fetish.
Dude, eventually, like the fucking married lights off missionary, it's gonna be the fetish.
Because it'll go so far, it'll go so far, and it'll get right back on the mountain.
I don't know if I sent you this or not.
The universe must have so many.
It says it's got the little thinking guy, and it says the porn sites in the Star Wars universe must have so many categories.
Yeah. I mean, there's so many different things out there.
What would be the one you'd be least interested in watching?
Jabba.
Yeah. There's no curiosity as to just how the physics work.
Oh no, fuck no!
I think they lay down beside each
as
other.
Weird as I am,
some sort of passing of mucus.
I know they get.
It's like two snails or slugs meeting.
Yeah, that's probably
true. I think they also can just fuck themselves, right? I know they turn into they can turn male or female and give birth. And Clone Wars, like Zero, like turned into a lady and was about to give birth. So like she's softer, like not as fucking cutthroat, and then that's when she got.
Huh. I thought that. Well, you know, I think the guy in what about Babu Frick, and from episode 9, the little guy that puts together 3PO's.
I mean, all these creatures had to come from somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. They had, yeah.
All right. I'm sorry. Twitch.
But there's no hybrid that we know of in Star Wars. That's the thing, right?
That's true. I've had that discussion before with people. I think like in casual conversation, like it doesn't seem like any of the biology works interspecies.
Oh, I see you haven't been on Tumblr lately.
I mean, so like they can fuck just like you can fuck a goat, but you can't make a fucking goat baby.
Goat baby, yeah, correct.
Yeah.
Who are you talking to?
Because or back in Alabama.
Way back in the woods where the weed plants grow.
Because like in D&D and stuff, you have like half elves and half dwarves and shit like that. Mm. Like not in Star Wars.
Mm-mm. I don't think you have any of that in, except I think that the Lord of the Rings, that like there's some shit between the goblin, the Uruk-hai, and the orc. There's some kind of shit going on there.
And you know fucking Aragorn fucked Liv Tyler, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right? There's a
man-elf
relationship.
Yeah.
We never saw the baby. But
you know what I was thinking about, not to cut you off?
Yeah.
If you were going to start your family now, would you?
What do you mean?
So, let's remove Mason from the scenario.
Mm-hmm.
If you were considering having Kennedy now,
based on our age?
No. Everything is the same as when you had Kennedy, except the time that you were living in.
So
it's 2020, and you are 30, whatever, or 20, whatever.
I don't. Yeah, it's hard to say. So a guy I work with, they've been trying to get pregnant, and his wife's, she's 5 months pregnant now, which I swear last time he told me that, it seemed like it was
2 months ago.
Right, and exactly. but, you know.
I don't think I would.
You don't think you would at all? Or mm-mm. just you'd wait to see how things shake out?
I'd probably at least wait to see. Okay. At least.
I could
at least.
Say that.
But like, just like so many things. I hate to feel like the old curmudgeon, you know, like the old, like my grandma would be like, I don't know about bringing children to this world. I was like 98.
I mean but like, to be honest, it was 98 at that age when I was seeing like shit like this would happen. That I'm like, I don't want to bring life into this.
Yeah, but I mean, like, there's a big difference between 98 and today. I feel like in terms of...
Oh, well, today you can see it. Like, back then, it was just a pessimist who, like, predicted the
correct,
shit.
Correct, yeah. correct. But, I mean, a pessimist is always going to be the pessimist, right? As opposed yeah. to... You know what I mean? So, like, I don't know. I don't know if I would do it. I don't know if I would do it today.
Yeah.
You know? But, or just had the baby. I'm just kidding.
It was fine a few years ago.
Yeah. The baby, that's my... I guess she's got me in her pocket. Anyway.
But yeah.
Continue.
Yeah, I think that's it. Like, doing 40K, fucking listening to No Sleep on YouTube. It's the usual. That's what I do my pastime.
Chris Pinkerton, if you're nasty.
Is it my turn to run?
Mm-hmm. You got a DVD this week.
Bobby is returning to me. I bought the John Wick Blu-ray DVD digital. Is this? I don't even know how these work. Oh, there's the other disc.
Okay. And the digital code.
Yeah, so I'll probably take the digital
code. Best of both worlds.
Because I've been wanting to listen to the commentary on this, and the copy I have at home, that I don't know, something's wrong with it. Anyway, so I'll probably upload the digital and to listen to that. Forgot to close my notes. So I listened to my whole setup. So when I was working in the shop, I had my computer and I was watching something and listening while I was working. Well, second machine set up, that computer was being used for that, so I didn't have anything to watch. So just listening to stuff. I listened to a lot of music, and I was flipping through podcasts. I'm like, man, do I really want to listen to anybody talk for that long? I stumbled upon Joe Rogan and Post Malone. Holy shit. It's 3 hours long.
Oh, God.
They get just completely baked, and they're drinking Bud Light because that's what Post Malone's sponsored right. by, whatever. It is crazy. It was very entertaining. It definitely didn't seem like 3 hours.
Oh, well, good.
So, and
to me, it sounds grueling because anytime I hear Post Malone talk for more than 20 seconds, I'm like, all right. And I love his music, but I don't like him listening to him or looking at him.
He says a lot of just, I mean, he's 25 years old. He says a lot of just dumb stuff, but they get into some funny stuff. It's entertaining. So, if you're a fan of either of those, did you know that Post Malone has a limited edition line of Crocs?
I did not know that.
No. Well, now you know. You can get your posty Crocs.
You know, I've never tried Crocs on.
I have one time, and I thought they hurt my feet.
Oh, really?
But I wear those Adidas bumpy sandals.
I love them. I like them.
What I love is, like, if I'm wearing sneakers or what boots or whatever all day, and I come home and I put those on, it's like a little massage. It's like a little massage. I was talking to a listener today, a friend of mine I talk to rather often, and he was asking me about... I'm trying to find it. So us getting, you know, the business thing. And I said, if it wasn't for wifey, this wouldn't be happening. And this was his response. Well, they are the lifeblood of the household. I know I'd probably be living under a bridge without mine. There would still be Detoffs under the bridge, though.
So, who was that?
It's Todd.
Okay. Todd R. Yeah, Todd R. is a good dude.
He hit me up earlier today to ask. I woke up the other day. My face was all red and bumpy. And I didn't know what to do. It hurt. It was unlike anything I'd ever dealt with. And I showed it to Kelly. And I was like, you know, what should I do? She's like, well, don't make any rash decisions, Joe.
Oh,
my God. Fuck my life. Really?
Well done.
Fuck, day one?
You knew I had to come with some heat. I had to come with some heat.
Whoa.
So I think I broke my tailbone. And this actually happened a couple of weeks ago. Oh, it gets better.
He broke his ass.
I got choked out by a 7-year-old. So me and Charlie are goofing off.
Have you told your wrestling buddies?
Well, none of them could ever choke me out. So, we were just, you know, wrestling around, and I had him in like a piggyback, and he had his legs wrapped around me, and he let go. So Charlie's a healthy boy. He's probably 50, 60 pounds now. I don't know how much he weighs. He had his hands around my neck, and I was like, oh, I'm getting a little lightheaded. Charlie, it's probably time to get down. I woke up on the floor. I mean, it could have been a lot worse. Like, we were right. You guys have been in my living room. We were like, you know, we got that little ottoman thing.
Yeah.
And that TV display, basically, I think it's a bested thing.
Right.
And, like, he's crying, and I literally have no idea what's going on. And Kelly runs over. She's like, what happened? And I'm like, I didn't know even what to say. I was embarrassed, really, because I didn't. So later after we got him calmed down, he was fine. I mean, I could have landed on him.
Right.
I mean, he could have hit the corner of the
Yeah, it could have gone a number console. Of different ways.
I was like, I guess he choked me out. I don't know.
Wow.
A couple days later, Kelly was playing with him, and kind of the same thing. He was pulling, and she's like, wow, I could definitely see, because it just gets that one artery in your neck. But I landed, and it didn't hurt initially, but it hurt really bad. So I think I bruised or cracked or something, my coccyx. Yep. And there's nothing you can do about it.
No.
Right? We're going to put you in an ass cast.
You know, you get a donut.
Yeah, you donut sitting on motherfucker.
So, I mentioned this before we started today, because these very fashionable stools that we use here, but actually it's perfect. I guess because it's wide and kind of I can spread out. So, like, my office chair, I have a pillow in my chair now.
Yeah.
It doesn't bother me. Like, if I'm sitting or standing, it doesn't bother me. But it's like if I'm bending over a bunch to pick up something. So, like, we got remote switches for my vacuums for the shop now, so I don't have to bend over much to do anything. And I guess it'll kind of heal itself as time goes by. But, yeah, I got choked out by a 7-year-old.
Yeah, hate to hear it.
And broke your ass.
Hate to hear that, too. Hate to feel it.
It's not a good feeling. We did our debut last night for our next couple mythic pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Set three with the you can go on YouTube, our Crash Box Customs YouTube, and see the reveal. The website, Kelly's, bless her heart, our web mistress and our painter and photographer. So
yeah, she's been great, man.
She's doing she's taking pictures of everything. So the website will actually be pre-orders go live Saturday at 10 a.m. Eastern. If you're interested, and
all on the website,
everything's pushed to the website now.
That's fucking cool, man.
Dude, it makes
it's awesome.
It makes.
Is it exciting too to be like check it? Like you check it every couple hours. Like
we're using Shopify, and I have the app on my phone, and it's cha-ching.
Yeah, I love. Cha-ching. Hey, love to hear it.
Yeah. So we're excited. We got the reaction was good, and we're looking forward to seeing. How it goes, we did a collaboration with this 3D print company, myactionfigurecustoms.com. They're huge in the mythic world. They do custom.
In the real world.
In the, sure. In the mythic. In the mythic community. But, they do the custom heads, and literally, I don't know if you can completely build a figure with all the stuff they make, mm-hmm. but. Like, they did a Too Bad torso.
Mm-hmm.
You remember Too Bad from He-Man?
The two guys that were connected in the middle.
Yeah, there was two of them, and they were bad. So
correct, Too Bad.
You know how complicated those He-Man...
The one I never figured out was Manny Faces. What's the E for,
Oh, it stands for Ernest. speaking of those, I wasn't going to mention this, but... my wife loves Masters of the Universe. That was like her and her brother played Masters of the Universe, when they were kids. She has fond memories of it. And she picked up a Castle Grayskull at a toy show. Remember those mm-hmm. toy shows?
Mm-hmm. Shit.
Well, you never went to them anyway, so it doesn't matter.
It's not fair.
Do you ever think about, like, right now, like, fuck, I really wish I had gone to more.
Oh, I wish I would have gone to that last one that New York Mike went to. 100%. Think about it all the time.
Yeah, I was there.
So the thing is that like my job is not a Monday through Friday job.
Right.
That's what makes it fucked up for me. Where like I would love to go and would love to have gone more often, but like on the rare chance that I'm off on the Saturday, I'm not off on the Sunday or vice versa. And even if it was just a one day show, it's like, man, you drive all the way to Pennsylvania, you spend all the day walking around, you come back home, you're fucking exhausted just to get up and go to work tomorrow. It's like, I know I'm old and trash, but I'm old and trash.
Right.
And, if any of that shit was ever like on a Saturday where I didn't have to work the next mm-hmm. day, I would have gone,
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm just picking at you.
No. I'm saying
the situation is always
more so to the ether. Like, yeah. Hopefully things will fold out that way at some
hopefully.
Point.
Hopefully. Saying that to say, there's a new, and forgive me because there's been a million He-Man lines just like Ninja Turtles, but I believe it's the, He-Man Origins line, Masters of the Universe Origins. So basically, it's the same scale as the original at 5.5 inch, you know, where they were just 5 points of particular legend. Well, they basically gave him elbows, wrist swivels, and knees, which makes a ton of difference. Mm-hmm. They might have ankle articulation. Anyways, so shout out to the realm in general for helping us find these, because I haven't seen hardly any of it. But we got the He-Man and the Skeletor, and they're great. Mm-hmm. I mean, do they look like the cartoons? No.
Right.
But it's what she wants.
But it looks like the toy.
It looks like the toy. Yeah. It's articulated. You know, you can put your two swords together.
And there's fucking merit there. Like, it doesn't... Not everything has to look like the cartoon.
It doesn't.
There's nothing wrong with wanting the toy representation or some other fucking representation.
Exactly.
You see that in Transformers, like when third party does recolor, that's like the toy, with the stickers that like the toys.
100%. If going down the same logic, I much prefer the classics He-Man line over the Filmation line or the toy line.
Right.
Just because it's like, oh man, this is like a modern cool look. You know what I mean? Like, it's just preference of style.
Sure.
And it's good to have multiple lines that covers everything.
100%. Exactly. Like, Super 7's kind of doing it too, right? Where they have like the toy turtles, you know, and then NECA has the movie and Toon Turtles.
At two different retailers. right, you need a spreadsheet to keep up with it. But we got those two. We got Battle Cat and the Sky Sled with Prince Adam. And we've got Beastman on the way, just kind of looking for the rest of it. I think a lot of Walmarts are getting a huge end cap of it, so I think it's all going to show up. Hmm. I don't remember why I was making that point. But anyway, I just basically, if anybody's wanting to check it out, it's been a cool line.
Right.
Picked up some G.I. Joe stuff.
You got the Baroness.
I found the Baroness today. Shout out to the Pop Finder app. If I couldn't get it to work on my phone for the longest time. I got up this morning and checked it. I'm like, boop, I got up later than I normally do, and I got the Target like 20 minutes after they opened, which I figured out. I think getting the Target when they open is a moot point, because I don't think they – I think everybody gets to Target at like 7:30, and they start working at 8. You know, like, I don't think they get there at 5.
Right.
They work like freight during the store opening hours.
I have one secured for me.
Okay.
But I don't want to count my chickens before they hatch, because I'll say, yeah, I got one, and shout out to everything's working out perfect. And then arrives fucking just one side of the box comes. You know what I mean? Because then USPS dog ate the rest of it.
Tell you what, USPS. So we're offering going forward a UPS option for shipping as well, because so many parts of the country are having just horrible issues with the Postal Service. I'll tell you that the two bigger pieces of the Masters of the Universe plus some Simpsons stuff that Paul C. found, I don't know, a year ago waiting to bring it to me at Skullfest.
Yeah.
He sent it out. I emailed him a priority label. It took 13 days to get to my house. And the majority of that time of tracking just said arriving late. Picked up in the city he lives in, arriving late. But thank you to Paul for doing
Paul's,
that.
Paul's one of the good ones, man, for sure.
But, you know, you hear other horror stories. I know Mezcos have been coming in, the wholesale. Actually, this is interesting. The Harley Quinn and the most recent version of Batman, those have come in the past 2 weeks wholesale for me. It had been January since I had a wholesale Mezco order come in.
Yeah,
I didn't realize.
You had mentioned that to me in the car, and it was kind of like eye opening.
Yeah.
And now Chris, I would never in a million years put you in a position where you'd have to say anything negative about Dad. But like, is that because they've been handling most of their stuff exclusively through their own stores?
So that is part of it. So they've been doing a lot of in-house releases instead of doing wholesale stuff.
But I mean, it makes sense.
I'm like, Gambit hits next week. I'll have Gambit next week from them. So it's bang, bang, bang. And there's a couple others. So they have a channel through previews as well, which be interesting to see if that changes any with the changes at Diamond and losing the DC distribution and all that.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see how that comes out. But yeah, they've been doing it, you know, their in-house exclusives, their proprietary stuff, the Gomez and whatnot. There's been a couple of releases. Like, I didn't get the Carol Danvers wholesale because nobody wanted it. And, Pennywise from It, I didn't get that whole, but it came out. Those were like in March, you know, and it's just been this huge gap. So I just thought that was interesting from a distribution standpoint. And I also got the, I guess it's the SDC, would have been the SDCC Cobra Commander. It'll actually go up for pre-order in September, but I made a friend in Hong Kong, so being able to
get my people's
get stuff. It's funny because he's not your people's, but he lives in Hong Kong, which makes it all the more interesting dynamic.
Nationally, he's your people's.
Yes, he is. And finally, finished Game of Thrones last night.
And?
I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
I'm fine with it. It never saw it coming, mm-hmm. the last episode. I never saw him killing her. Mm-hmm. I know that when you have power.
Yeah.
And how that can go horribly wrong.
What did you think
before that was hard to watch.
Yeah.
They were burning the city.
So what did you think about that? Because the only reason why I bring it up, I've had that conversation with a lot of people.
I'm sorry, Joe, have you watched Game of Thrones?
No.
And he's not going to, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you'd like it.
What if we colored it in? What if you could paint by numbers it? I asked this because I've had this conversation and ended up on the opposite side of the argument most of the time, but a lot of people have said like that they didn't find her violent turn believable. And I felt like I saw it coming. Like this breadcrumb trail of her feeling alone and isolated, mm-hmm. and that she could trust no one.
Like
you know
when
I mean?
They were in Winterfell and everybody's over here bullshitting and chuckling with Jon.
And she was over there by herself. Yeah.
And Varys is over there doing his little. Yeah.
Yeah. I felt like it wasn't a shocking character point for me. It was like, fuck, this is the road that she's on. And this is where that road ends.
If I'm giving it a score of 10 out of 1, between 1 and 10 for the entire episode, the entire thing, I'll give it probably a 9.
Yeah.
A 9.5.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
The couple things, just look at broad strokes here. The Arya's time with the...
Hold on. Sorry, Arya's time.
Her time with the faceless, the faceless man. I mean, it was kind of confusing.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, I don't know how much of that I needed. And we got a lot of it.
Well, we did, and I think the it was obviously building her to be a murderer, to be an assassin, to be able to do these things,
and to give her a skill set. I just feel like it's one of those things where it's like, if it was in the 80s, it would have been a 2-minute and 30-second montage, but instead it was like a whole season.
I think in the books that's probably a bigger part of the story.
Yeah, yeah. I actually read Robert's them.
Really?
Yeah.
I was actually just reading a blurb. I guess the he's. Still churning on this last book, and I guess she's still in, what city was she in when she was...
I'm not good with the names, I get all ate up.
Anyways, wherever that was, she's, like, in the book, she's still there, there's a lot of stuff. The whole Three-Eyed Raven thing, just, it was, I was like, I felt like I missed 2 or 3 episodes that focused on that.
Yeah.
It's like, what the hell am I missing here?
Yeah, that's fair, too. There were a couple loose ends, I agree, that
they,
I felt like.
Yeah, and they call them, is it a wog, when they can see through the, like, when he was controlling, the big guy.
Yeah.
What was his name?
Hodor.
Oh, that was heartbreaking. When you find out why.
Yeah, that was a big one.
Like
that was. I mean, it just made the hairs on my arm stand.
Me too. So me and Kelly. You know, basically, we'll watch it at night,
uh-huh.
and we watch it while we're sitting in bed or whatever. Oh, we were both just like.
Dude,
and that's so not a good show to watch and go to bed because all you do is try to process it overnight and work it in, but.
Palate cleanser afterwards. Hmm? Every time we watch something serious, we watch like some fucking fail video on YouTube to like palate cleanse.
I guess that's probably a good idea. But yeah,
I follow a few Instagram accounts like that now because Jisk is always sending me shit like follow this was like girls falling down.
As far as the breadcrumb trail to her, I'm going to say losing her mind.
Yeah.
To the Targaryen mindset. It's
yeah, and also like that, like you know, if you look at her. Her journey,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just a punch in the face after a punch in the face after a punch in the face. And like at a certain, like every person has their fucking, their tipping point, you know, like, and I just think that hers had so much weight on it that when it finally tipped, it was just a lot to fall.
yeah, I don't know. I mean, like the fact that she decided to burn the entire city down and you know, obviously Cersei's dead and that's the point.
So let me ask you this. Who's your favorite character?
I'll list some of my favorite characters.
Okay.
Tyrion.
Mm-hmm.
I like Sam Tarly.
Okay.
Sam, who was Lord Tarly, and they didn't even mention, hey, your entire bloodline's gone, so you're now the Lord of House Tarly. They didn't mention that. I liked Ser Davos.
Okay.
I liked him.
Refresh my memory of who he is.
So he was the one.
Oh,
that
he was like
with, he was with
the older man. Yeah.
He was with Baratheon.
Yeah.
I like Robert Baratheon in the beginning, but uh-huh. obviously we didn't get much of him. I tell you who I don't like Sansa at all. I mean, who names their kid after a memory card anyway?
Really, that's interesting. I liked her. She's not my favorite.
By the end, it's like she's such a cunty bitch. I mean, like, I don't know.
Well, speaking of which, Cersei's my favorite character in that fucking show.
She's a piece of work.
And
I'll
tell you why. I don't view her as monstrously as I think you're supposed to.
Mm-hmm.
Because I do, to me, with her. See, not with Joffrey and not with Ramsay, who are both fucking monsters, right?
For sure.
and their motivations are selfish and power and greed and, you know, general avarice.
Mm-hmm.
Cersei's, to me, is... it's wider than that. It's about her lineage. It's about her family. And she will, at the end of the day, do anything for her children and for the legacy of her children.
Right.
Whereas my mother would do nothing. So I think that's where mine comes, like where I'm like, holy shit, this is the mom I deserved.
Here's a question for you. Who has the best redemption arc in that series?
The brother. The stepbrother or whatever, the bastard brother, the brother that wasn't really a brother, that had his dick and nuts cut off.
Oh, Theon.
Yeah.
I said the same thing.
Yeah, for sure.
I said he has the best redemption arc.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, in general, one of the top tier, like Vader, like he's in that pocket for me, like of conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool.
But yeah, I'm glad I watched it. Kelly only watched literally the second half, so I'm trying to talk her. And it's like, why don't we watch?
Right.
I'm happy to watch it again.
Yeah.
And then it would be like you watching the prequels, and you'll probably be like, oh.
So I my Daenerys statue finally came off wait list.
I've heard about this,
and I bought it, and somebody else bought one. I don't know if he's put it out there.
I've heard about that.
So
I was.
It's not my horn to toot.
This was him, and uh-huh. here's him buying it. We just shoved him right off the edge.
But
it's a major purchase.
Yeah, and it's fucking and for him because it's like his first. I had to dip my toes in a little bit. I was like, let me start out with the like, Evelyn at 300. I had to.
It's like you could buy a Buick Regal with that.
But it's for those that are listening. It's a Prime One with Blitzway. I'm not sure how that works. Do you know how that works?
No.
So Blitzway is its own company, right? Like they did like the 1/6 scale Ghostbusters. Mm-hmm. They've done like a number of things. It says Prime One on the Spec Fiction website. Mm-hmm. It says Prime One on the Sideshow website.
Mm-hmm.
But when I got the email that the waitlist was open, it said the Blitzway such and such. And then when I got the email that confirmed my purchase, it said your Blitzway such and such. But when I go to the site, it's like Prime One with Blitzway and all that. I just don't understand what's going on there.
Nice collab, or maybe it's the same has a parent company.
Yeah, it's Prime One and Blitzway are proud to present the first collaboration piece.
There you go.
I wonder why. I wonder what's going on. Like looking at Prime One's work, looking at Blitzway's work, it doesn't seem to be their bag.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at Prime One's work, it doesn't seem like they need any help.
I think so.
Yeah, I just ordered a Berserk quarter scale.
So
the other day.
This doesn't lay it out, but I'm thinking it was, we want to use your artist that's signed to your to do this. I almost guarantee you that's what it is.
So I don't know if you've seen the piece, but it's and for the listeners.
Yeah, I've seen that. Yeah.
She's like sitting on the throne. She's got all the baby dragons like around her, like, and once again, she's far from my like Cersei's my girl. I like Daenerys as much as the next guy, but there's something about the piece, to me, that speaks to the entire series as opposed to a single piece. So, like, it's almost like that Vader when we went in there and I was like, I think it was Adam who coined that phrase. He said that Vader tells the whole story up until that time.
Right.
And I think that's kind of the magic I'm looking for with the quarter scale stuff is something that is beautiful in and of itself, but speaks to something.
Yeah, if you have an attachment to it, you can see the whole tapestry.
Yeah, something about the creation, the creative sculpt of it speaks to something larger than what it is to me.
Are you going to display your Flight of Dragons with it?
So let me tell you. Let me tell you.
So we
redid the kitchen and shit, right? I'm getting very excited. So we redid the kitchen and shit. And we also, we painted our bedroom different color. And it's made a world of difference in the bedroom. Like it was a darker color in there too. And like, I can never find my socks and shit. Like now it's a brighter color. I can see everything. Just perfect. So we're looking for art to put on the wall. And I had always wanted, we ended up going with it, but there's this artist out there named Michael Parks, and he does like kind of fantasy-esque stuff, but there's something almost fairy tale about it. I got turned on to a piece of his where this girl is like standing on a ledge. It's a painting, and she's I think she's blowing either with a bubbles or like one of those things. It's like a weed, and you blow and you make a wish, one of those things. But she's standing on
a dandelion.
There you go.
Say it, Bobby.
Is that a dandelion? Is that the yellow thing too?
No, dandelions are the white things.
What are the yellow things?
Are y'all serious?
I know what a dandelion is.
So no, they're yellow.
What do I got?
Then
a green
thumb? Turn to the things you blow.
Really?
That's how it works.
You know what's funny, man?
You know that, right?
Yeah, man? I know that.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know shit about weeds. There's only one type of weed I know anything about.
Okay.
My front yard growing up was smaller than this room.
You don't have a...
My backyard growing
no,
up...
it's not green.
No, not at all. My backyard growing up, twice the size of this room.
Was there any grass?
Barely.
Okay.
Like, I mean, I had a little bit. Like, I have... My yard now is small, but it is 6 times bigger than the yard I had growing up.
So you have a huge yard.
Now?
In your head, I mean...
In my head, yeah. In my head, it's like, how do you manage all this?
You probably think I'm like crazy for having.
I think you're crazy.
I don't think you're. I'm envious. Yeah. Because I wish I had more space. But like,
dude, I can piss off any door, out of any door, not on the door.
Well, they say if you live in Maryland and you don't live in fucking a place where no one wants to live in Maryland, you either can get the house of your dreams or the land of your dreams, but somewhere you're gonna have to compromise on the other.
Oh, I got both. I want. I want a big house on a tiny land.
Right. Well, it's like not every shoe fits every foot, Joe.
Yeah.
But like, so like, I have like my house. If in a perfect world, I would have either one less kid or one more room. But and it's not really. It's not even so much for me.
Says the man with 2,500 square foot of toys.
So there you go. So it's not so much for me. I wish my wife had a space.
You could very much give up some of your space for her.
Look, Joe. Let's not go crazy. I already told her she can have the kitchen.
Well, she did paint the bedroom, so.
So anyway, she's like blowing a little thing, and I don't know if it's bubbles or a dandelion.
I just want to hear you say dandelion.
And I'm gonna tell you something else. I don't think dandelions look bad in the yard when they're yellow. When I drive past the house and I see they got dandelions, I'm like, oh, they're pretty flowers. But like, so be that as it may, this gargoyle was obviously sitting on the ledge as a stone and has come to life to chase these bubbles or this thing that this girl is blowing. We saw it like when we first bought a house, we always wanted to buy it, never had a space for it. So we never put anything in our bedroom. Now that we've painted our bedroom, I was like, man, let's get that fucking thing. You know, and now we're doing Michael Parks all over the room. So it's very nice. And I don't know why I'm saying all this.
Flight of Dragons.
Flight of Dragons. So in order to get there, in order to find those pieces, we Googled art. And the first thing that comes up is going to blow your mind. Art.com. So I go to art.com, and I'm trying to find this Michael Parks piece. So
did you know his name?
Yes.
Okay.
So because I follow him on Facebook and shit and the whole nine, but I didn't put in Michael Parks in the search engine because it has a tab and it said fantasy. So I just clicked fantasy. I know it's in the fantasy section. And they have the Flight of Dragons artist in the catalog that they offer of prints from art.com.
Really?
Yes. So I can tell you that I am going to get rid of the girl sitting in the meadow as you walk down the steps, and a Flight of Dragons piece is going to go there, and that's going to be my representation of Flight of Dragons, because you can't get any other fucking representation of Flight of Dragons aside from the DVD. So that's what I'm going to do.
That's cool.
Yeah. And then I feel like that's a meaningful check, you know, in the box, so to speak. Remember when Omadon was doing that thing and he had the little toys out there? I was always envious of the toys he had.
Oh my God.
I was like, dude, I want a Gorbash that looks just like that, and a fucking Smurgle, and a fucking, you know, the whole crew.
I have one more game.
Empire
Final Fantasy.
Probably.
This is me not being plugged into it when it came out. But I remember hearing some scuttlebutt about, really? That's the end of the White Walkers?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, what did... obviously, it's, you know, she sneaks up on him and does the... does the saber drop and gets him.
Yeah,
that was like, oh, okay. All right, was that around the same... I don't know time frame-wise when that...
So I liked her... So I kind of felt like the battle... I wish the battle was during the day so I could see what was going on.
I will say that the way that was... I think it made me have anxiety the way edited it. And I think they did that shit on purpose. Me and Kelly, I was like, what the fuck? Why is this shot like a Michael Bay movie? Because it was. It was explosions and quick cuts. And it was not shot the way the rest of the show had been.
That's fair. I'll concede that point. But I loved the assassination.
Yeah,
I loved it.
I mean that one the scene when John's falling him down and he just turns around and looks at him and here comes back to life all of your soldiers. And
yeah,
I'm like, fuck.
Yeah,
and then in the crypt when they came out, I'm like, fuck.
Yeah.
Fuck. There's nowhere to go.
Yeah, I fuck with that world, man.
Yeah, for sure. There's supposed to be some sort of prequel, sequel, side story stuff.
I have heard that.
They're freaky deep.
I mean, the real books are still coming at some point.
Maybe. Yeah, that too.
The what?
The real books are maybe.
And then the real ending is coming at some point. Get the audio book.
What about you, Bobby?
So I didn't really do much. I worked on a bunch of videos to try to get a little bit ahead, and I got some pretty harsh criticism on one of my videos, and like I had to take a step back because I was like. You're an asshole. There's a better way to do what you just did, but you're not entirely wrong either.
Which one?
It was a Black Series figure.
Okay.
And
shiny.
I missed something. And I missed something because I've kind of been moving at 100 miles per hour recently. So he wasn't wrong, and I've taken it as criticism and I'm trying to course correct. But I'm not incredible with the way he said it, and like to me it's like you know there was a little bit of bumpers on there of like you know I love your reviews or whatever, but to me if that's how you feel, and you feel the need to say something, like you don't do it public. You know, there's a conversation to be had about the internet, right? It's a magical place, but like while for all the good that it does and information that it allows you to kind of instantly access and all those beautiful things, and you can order food and all that kind of stuff, the what it has done, it has made people write checks that they can't cash. and like that's my biggest problem, is that you have a generation of people that are not being taught how to move in a room. And what I mean by that is when you grow up in the real world and you can only communicate in the real world, at a certain point, you say something to someone, and you get, speaking of course corrections, you get your course corrected.
Correct.
And you learn a valuable lesson that there are consequences for your actions, and that you just can't say anything to anyone, and there's value to that. And it's a bigger lesson, I think, than I've ever given it credit for. But like, it teaches you how to approach everyone. Because you start to feel shit out. You start to, you know, have this like metaphorical game of chess with people where you're like, oh, okay, all right, so it's cool if we're cool here. Don't play around here. We're not playing around here. There's a line here for this person and they're not playing around there. And what I worry about with like my kids, I mean, not my kids, they're girls, are not going to have, you know, the same problems that I feel like I had as a man in the world, but like these boys, you know, that like growing up in this world where they don't get that valuable lesson. And then one day as an adult, you know, because you're not really getting hurt at like 10 or 12, you know, you get your eye popped and you're like, oh, fuck, okay. You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, now when that same punch is thrown at 23 in college, that's going to land different. And that's a hell of a time to learn that lesson.
Yeah.
So it has made me think about that a bit. Is that like, you know, everybody talks about like, oh, you would never say that shit to my face. You know what I mean? But like, whenever I say anything that's like in that pocket, I don't really mean it in like the machismo way. I mean it in the like, it's almost like a criticism of you and not a pumping up of me.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's like, that's what's wrong with the world in a way, not totally, but in this circumstance, where people will communicate and they don't have to be held accountable for what they say, not in any real way. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean for the person? You know, this person probably is well on their way to being whoever they are, but the person that is 7, 8, 9, what does that mean for that person when they're 25?
Yeah.
But, I mean, they're going to be surrounded by the same people. There's a difference.
That's true. That's true. But you still, so you don't know how people are going to react, right? Mm. So even though the other person is the same way, raised in the same culture, and now you said something about their grandmother, they react how they're going to react, you know, knowingly or unknowingly. I think I have things that, like, you know, I have certain things where, like, if you were to, like, hurt my kid, you know, or my wife, like, my body just reacts in a way, and then we'll pick up the pieces, you know, later
right.
on.
Right.
And I think everybody has that threshold. So even though they're not, even though that same individual is probably maneuvering in his world the same exact way, it's still going to create that lesson for the other individual. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
It's the coming of age of internet. It's a societal shift. We've never been here. Mm-hmm. It's completely new. Like, the entirety of human existence has changed, and we're all feeling it out. We have no idea where shit is going to land.
Yeah. Because it's like, I mean, I kind of walk through this world kind of with one hand on my nuts in general and the middle finger up in the other, you know, to an extent. But there are definitely people in this world that I bumped into, and I've been like, okay, I can do that here. But I'm going to have to be ready to play how he plays, you know? And, like, maybe I'll maneuver different in that space, you know? Because I don't mean any harm. It's like, you know, there's somebody throwing the bowling ball almost. It's like, you know, like, the bowling ball doesn't mean to knock over the pins. Sometimes the fucking pins fall. I don't know. All right. I'm trying to think if I did anything else. I watched some South Park this week. Just because I can.
Surprised.
Yeah, well,
like, doesn't sound like something you would just choose to do.
Like, it's been like, I'll put it on because I'm tired and I need something to fill 20 minutes of time that I'm going to need 15 of them to fall asleep.
<That's fair.
laughs> But I'll tell you, I haven't watched South Park in years, and like I was aware that they had kind of gone to this overarching thing for seasons, not self-contained episodes.
Yes, I knew that.
So they're not self-contained episodes anymore. Every season has a theme.
It's an overall story.
Yeah. I don't like it. I like the self-contained meal with South Park. I like to sit down, commit to this concept, have a laugh, challenge me possibly on a few things, and then
move on
to the next one. I don't enjoy, and I don't think that the overall arcing story has been of great value to what I look for in South Park, which is either LOLs or to be challenged.
Mm-hmm. I haven't watched in a couple of years, but yeah, I remember when they made that shift. They started doing like some miniseries, like a few episodes that are linked, and mm-hmm. then they still have the episodic stuff, and then after a while, it was like all linked.
Yeah. Still enjoy it, mm-hmm. but I just like, I don't get much out of this new format for
That's
it.
Fair.
And I don't think I've done much else. So let's talk about the Turtles line a little bit. And we got a couple questions that maybe we'll get to. I'll try to get to them. We haven't done an Irregulars Collectors episode in some time.
Fucking at least a year.
And we've had Raul was like, you know what? I could really go for an Irregular Collectors episode. So I figured we could do a little bit of both, since there's no need to have this conversation. You know what I mean? Like, same cast for both.
Right.
what do you remember about? Let's start here. We're gonna cover the original Ninja Turtles toy line, and I'm gonna try to cover the first couple years of it before it starts getting real goofy. But we're gonna come back for the goofy shit another day. What was your first memory of it? Like, introduction to it, etc.
I mean, my first memory of Turtles was I was at my grandmother's house and just on, like, the local TV station some summer day that Teenage Mutant, that came on. And I'm like, whoa, what the hell? This is awesome. And then I remember seeing, you know, the toys in the store. And I'm like, oh, those don't look like the cartoon at all. But they're still cool. I had the Turtles and I had the four Turtles, and that might have been all I had. I never got... I never really got super into them. I was,
and they were towards the end of your further towards the end of your childhood.
Because I'm, you know, I'm kind of long in the tooth.
Long in the tooth.
So, you know, G.I. Joes and was really what I was focused on back then.
Right.
And I dabble in other stuff. I had a couple, you know, Silverhawks. I'm like, oh, these are gonna, you know, these don't look great after a while. Thundercats. I could never find Thundercats as a kid. I had the Walrus guy and Slythe, and that's the only two. I never saw them in the stores. So, I mean, that's, yeah, Turtles was, you're right. I'm probably 3 years away from
Because like
really a Turtle fan.
I feel like Turtles for you was probably Mighty Morphin Power Rangers for me, where like by the time that started hitting for me, I was like, you want me to watch this guy dance around in this little suit when this girl is sending me notes?
Hey, I was all about that. My senior year in high school is when Mighty Morphin Power Rangers came out. I had all, like, I bought all the
toys. Oh, you went heavy on it.
I had the white Zord. I remember being excited to go to the movie theater and see the movie.
I was like, man, Wu-Tang is out. I can't be listening.
Diversity. It was like Wu-Tang and Power Rangers at the same time.
But it didn't feel right for a changing person.
I probably took my 64 and Pilot to the theater to watch the Power Rangers movie.
Wow.
It tells you something about my life.
Yeah, that's for sure. What about you, Joe?
Oh, like, my past with Turtles spans my migration. So, like, I first, Turtles came out when I was in Hong Kong still, and I remember that. And I didn't have a choice. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I didn't have much choice growing up. But, like, one of the going away gifts when we came to America is, like, my grandfather's brother gave me a Game Boy, the old black and white Game Boy, and it had a Turtles game. And that was what I had of Turtles for the longest time till summer camp. Mm-hmm. I remember, like, in summer camp, like, people brought the toys and shit, and always the most memorable thing to me was the transforming turtles.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They were like the babies.
Yeah, the one kid that had the turtle that turned into a Ninja Turtle, and like that just, and me being interested in Transformers and engineering and shit like that always.
That was definitely the point of doing that.
Oh, for sure.
That's what stuck out to me of all the turtle lines. Like, I liked all the toys, and I had some experience playing with them of other people's, but those were the ones that stood out.
And I just had another memory about turtles. I remember eighth grade, the day, last day of eighth grade, me and my mom took, like, me and three of my friends to the mall, and we went to the arcade, and we all had a roll of
Turtles in Time
and beat the game.
Yeah, that game.
That game
had a huge impact on me.
That might have been, when did the live action come out? Was that 90?
89, I think.
So let's see.
89, 90, definitely
somewhere
in there.
So that was my freshman year in high school. And I mean, I don't know if I paid attention to Turtles much after that movie. I thought it was cool, but
there's a conversation to be had about movies killing franchises.
What? Well, yeah, there is. I don't know. No, that's necessarily what happened, but I think I just...
And I'm not saying that it is either.
On, but yeah, but I agree. I mean, the first Transformers live action movie turned me off from collecting Transformers.
The cartoon Transformers killed that franchise.
When they killed all the characters?
The cartoon movie.
Yeah, when they killed all the characters and brought in season 3.
Sure.
You know, the G.I. Joe one killed G.I. Joe. The Turtles one, it didn't kill... I mean, it didn't kill any of these franchises forever. It just killed... Like the momentum at the moment. Yep, the Turtles did it. Mighty Morphin Power Rangers did it. Fucking Spice Girls did it. Like, you know, as soon as the Spice Girls had a movie, their fucking wave ended. Like, there's a conversation to be had there, but I don't have all the details for it.
Yeah, Turtles was always more video games because it was the arcade game.
Arcade game was so fucking great. And the fact that they looked just like the cartoon used to blow my mind.
When you can throw them at the screen.
Yeah, especially with how shitty the fucking Nintendo game looked.
Yeah, and
comparison.
And it's the only, like, it's the Game Boy game, the arcade game, and my friend has the Super Nintendo game.
I don't know if I ever played that one.
I had it for Super Nintendo.
Yeah, so like Turtles was always
it was kind of like Turtles in Time, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, it's pretty close.
And like I was like Super Shredder was always my thing. I love Super Shredder. I'm like Turtles are silly. They're fucking Turtles, but Super Shredder, it's fucking Super Shredder.
Speaking of Super Shredder, we had a write-in about Australia, like that NECA refused to send this.
So NECA canceled their solicitation. Apparently, whoever was distributing their product in NECA had a falling out. So I guess anybody who had pre-ordered in Australia is shit out of luck now.
Wow. NECA is playing around in an arena that I don't think they're prepared for.
What do you mean?
So I feel like they've been playing in the kind of McFarlane well. Like, you can find our figures at comic book stores, and you can find our figures at entertainment stores, and now they're playing in the Hasbro and Mattel world. and I don't think they're prepared for it.
So Toys R Us, I think,
100%
part in them trying to find distribution channels. I mean, I think they have such a passionate following, especially for the turtle stuff, that they could probably just sell it on their website. But I think I mentioned it before. I don't know what the hell their agreements are with these companies because, you know, they're not on the toy aisle.
Shout out to Billings. He said that he was in some group and he mentioned I have the Leatherhead and like getting the tail attached. It's like it's not easy.
Yeah.
It's a double ball peg, but like the tail is spiky and the tolerances are trash. And like getting it to go, it like I should sue him.
My fingers hurt.
And anyway, like and Billy said he brought it up in some group and they did everything but crucify him. Anyway, we got a bit off subject. I remember seeing a buddy of mine, Nick Metzi, I think was his last name. He had a graphic novel of Turtles. Like a year before. It was the first time I'd ever seen anything turtle related. And his was black and white, right? And I have it, I think. I think I have it. Maybe I don't. But it had like one turtle on the corner of a building, and I think his mask was off, and he was kind of like looking off into the distance of the, and I was like, man, what is this? Like, you know, instantly captivated. So I went to the store. I told my dad, I was like, I want to read these fucking turtle books. And my dad's like, you want to read? You know, so he's like, so when I got to the thing, I saw those. And those are the ones that he bought me, the graphic novels that were like, they were color. Mm-hmm. So I like came into school, like, you know, with, I think it got me like one at a time over the course of so long. And I was like, look, I got these. They're in color. And this dude treated me like I had like the, like, man, like, you got the mainstream. Like, this is the real, this underground. I have the indie, you know, when they were cool. This is, now they sold out. Like, little did you know where this shit was going to go,
right,
you know?
Right.
So then,
hipster.
Correct. So then, like, the next thing I know, I was at Heroes World in the Columbia Mall and walked in there, and there on the racks was turtle figures. They had the four turtles and a foot soldier, I think. But no Shredder and no Splinter and no April, because that was all in the first wave or first couple waves. And I was like, fuck. So
you hadn't seen the cartoon.
I hadn't seen the cartoon yet. So, because like I had a hard, like I had to know when shit was going to come on to watch it, because like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I had Taekwondo. Tuesday, Thursday, I had baseball game on Saturday. And then while my mom was allowed to go to church, we had mass on Sunday. She was kicked out of the Catholic church, and then she became Episcopal, which is like diet Catholic. And then she got bored with the Episcopal thing, like, because Episcopal was kind of like more like a church. Like mass is like a thing you go to, and like everybody knows you just go because you gotta go. But like, anyway, there's a lot more kind of social commitment to the. It doesn't matter. We stopped going. and a nun stole my Matchbox car. So I told my grandmother, I was like, it was just her and I. I was like, I need all four. She's like, you can get two.
Oh.
And I was like, fuck. Okay.
Raphael and Leonardo.
So I got Raphael and Donatello because those are my two favorites from the comics. And they didn't do machines and shit, so it was a different squad, you know? So Donatello kind of plays the part of Raphael, I think, in one of the live-action movie, in one of the comics, where he goes out on his own, he gets his ass beat by the foot, they throw him through the building where the rest of the turtles are. Like, that's right out of that comic.
Oh, okay.
And, like, I was like, man, okay, so I got the two. We're halfway home, and I'm just looking at the back of the box. And my grandma was like, what? And I was like, they're four brothers, and she hit a U-turn and took me back and got me the other two. And like, wow. I'll have like this, like that memory, like just etched in my brain, like the how I felt of like, we're going. Like, you know, I'm going to have all four turtles. Like, that's it. No more details needed. I got my four turtles. So, my wife is sending me a picture of the NECA aisle right now.
Wow. There's not going to be anything there.
Because it was supposed that April drops today.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I found out some... basically, unless the NECA rep comes by, they say they lock that shit in the cage.
Yeah, like, that's...
You can't even get to it.
That's what I heard.
That's really fucking weird.
That's what I heard. All right, I'm just gonna tell her it doesn't look like it's there. Okay. So then she got me those, and then I was like, well, this shit has to have like a, there's got to be more, and you know, then we found the show. I used to rent the show because I had like a VHS of it.
Yep.
Oh my god!
Because I didn't have cable, so like everything like chung 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 and like fucking bunny ears to like make the shit work, and so I used to rent the show all the time, and it just had the pilot, you know, on there, and then I got obsessed with it. So like I was looking through some of this shit. And I was just amazed at like how much of it I had, you know, and how dumb of it's like, dumb, you know what I mean? Like how dumb some of that shit is, and what my dad must have thought of like buying that shit.
I mean, it's goofy. Like, you know, all 80s cartoons had a lot of goofy shit, but Turtles were real fucking goofy.
For sure, for sure. And but like some of this shit went way off the rails. So I was gonna bring up some of it. The shit started with the wave. This wave right here, which was, I think it was two waves. It was the Four Turtles, Splinter, April, Shredder, Rocksteady Bebop, and the Foot Soldier. So I'll tell you what memories I have of this. For one, the weapons were on a fucking sprue.
Yep.
The fact that the fucking the Foot Soldier was like a ape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Not like a human. Yeah. Like the proportions were like apish, and he'd always fall over and had a hard time standing. And the fact that April's hips were like on a swivel the same way that the turtles were, but because it's a narrower pelvis, she couldn't like take her foot out to the side or forward. It was
just
always
that angle.
Like at this awkward ass angle.
Those birthing hips.
Yeah. But you know what? It's funny to me, man. I never thought about it. Even like how all the turtles are different colors,
mm-hmm.
Like their flesh. As a kid, and even Shredder, like Shredder's like going buff, dude. Like no shirt. Like yo, yeah. What's the vibe?
I don't remember Shredder looking like that.
Correct. And he kind of sat like on bent knees as well. Like he mm-hmm. was like, but like to me, like you know, this is probably 88, 80. Oh, actually, I can find out. Oh, maybe I can't right here. But anyway, like 88. So that shit looked like it came right off the screen to me. You know, as like I'm seven,
mm-hmm.
you know, but like.
Did it ever cross any of your minds to army build like foot soldiers back then? Because it never did. Like I had G.I. Joes. I had three or four Cobra troopers. It never crossed my mind. I was like, man, I should have 40 of these.
So never like now. Like now where I'm like, yeah, like release the new stormtroopers. Fine. I'll buy just another one for the ranks.
Right.
But I remember thinking like, man, like it would be better if I had two.
Yeah.
You know, but I never had two because my dad would be like, you already have this one. He'd like draw the line.
Yep.
So then there was this vehicle, the Cheapskate, and it was like a
I just remember something I did have to this Turtles. It is a fucking plane. It's mm-hmm. a white and green plane, but like on the bottom of it has a handle, like a gun. And you load it with this fucking liquid and you put a trigger, quote unquote, smoke bombs would come out. It would be like bubbles.
Really?
It would be
like
that, like blowing that, bubble, but it was
like the Halloween smoke almost. Like
yeah, the, and it would be come out like you're talking about blowing bubbles.
I can smell that right now,
dude.
from train. Trains had that.
Yeah,
shit.
Yeah.
I completely forgot I had that. I got that for like Christmas when I was like 12 or 13 or something. Holy shit, crazy.
So
pocket where is it?
I had
where the fuck is it?
I had this Cheapskate.
I don't remember that at all.
So it was a skateboard. It had like a big fan on the back, and then it had the actual foot to fight the foot that was underneath, and was a push button spring activated thing so that you could flip up and kick the foot in the face.
No memory of that whatsoever.
And you were meant to. I think they pegged in here, and then he was meant to hold the handle of the Cheapskate. But like I forgot all about this shit, but I definitely had one. Like just like that's what was mind blowing to me about going through some of this stuff. The turtle blimp.
Yep, remember the shit.
Was that wasn't what you had, was it?
So no, because this didn't have that smoke effect.
No,
but
no, it was
it
a
did
plane.
Have,
it looked like a fighter plane.
When he started saying that he had the trigger, that's what I thought he was talking about. So like I had this turtle blimp, and here's what's funny about this: because of the size of it, this thing was fucking huge. Because of the balloon, for those that don't know, the Turtles blimp was like a big balloon. It had like some pretty decent paint of like the
yeah.
stuff on it,
yeah.
And then it was attached to a plastic part at the bottom, and then it had plastic kind of
so wings it's on basically the side. A giant beach ball with shit glued
yep.
to it.
Yep. Yeah. So the thing about it is, like, because of how big it was, I remember as a kid thinking to myself, like, oh my God, this must have cost my father a fortune. But this is probably like cheap as fuck.
It's probably like 20 bucks.
Yeah.
But
like, you pulled the trigger and it detached the hang glider part from the blimp so you could like fly around. You wouldn't have to have the big blimp all the time. But I definitely had it. This was the knucklehead. It was a, for those that remember, it was like a, it was like a spider thing. This was a foot.
This was vehicle. All the first
assortment of the first year. This so, is, yeah, I never had that shit.
Let me see.
92.
Yeah, that's way late in the game. That's 4 years in. That's 4 years
yeah,
into
that's
the franchise.
Years after I came to America. Like, yeah, I've
never seen it.
That's crazy. But this one, like, this would come down and grab the turtles, and yeah. It had like a string thing. I don't know if this was ever in the cartoon. A lot of this shit now, the turtle van, the party
yeah.
wagon.
Yeah. Yep. That's
that was a classic. Yep. And I had that. It's funny because I like this shit. It was like a little it was like the G.I. Joe paratrooper. It was called the Turtle Trooper. And had the little plastic bag that you drop off.
I think it's worth mentioning in just in general that, yeah. that this was essentially an unknown company making these figures because Playmates wasn't a player in the toy
yeah,
industry
that's true.
At the time.
That's true. And like there was also like a huge, I don't know, I'd be curious to see like what other licenses and stuff they had, because a lot of this stuff had a huge kind of like Toxic Avenger
yeah.
vibe mm-hmm. to it.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I never got this shit to work right. Like the G.I. Joe parachute, like none of the, like I never had this, but like.
Never had it fucking actually open up and.
I would go to somebody's house and we'd try it like off a balcony or something. The shit would just drop like a fucking lead balloon.
Yeah, it was a crap shoot, but I had a couple of the G.I. Joe ones. You kind of had to. It was all in the way you packed it, really. You had to kind of like fold it a certain way, and then it would catch.
Just like in real life.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. The G.I. Joe gliders were a crapshoot, too.
And this is when it gets wacky.
All right. So this.
The fucking. I remember the goddamn duck.
So this is 89.
Battletoad.
89. This is what caught me off guard about this. This is probably two waves of figures, I would say. And every single one of them is an original mold, and every single one of them is a B-string character. Like, this would, I feel like this would never fly today.
But Casey Jones and Yojimbo are fucking.
So
now.
Here's the crazy thing.
Not then.
Yojimbo was a. That was not their license. That was a.
Yeah, it's
a different
it's its own thing.
So, what's. And, does anybody know the story to that?
I don't, but
like because I know there's some tricky shit with the license because it is its own thing. But he was definitely called Usagi Yojimbo, and he mm-hmm. definitely hung out with the fucking turtles.
Yeah, and Usagi just means rabbit, so he's just fucking rabbit Yojimbo.
Rabbit Yojimbo. Yeah, but like, I'm sure there's a story to it. It reminds me of like the Macross fucking whatever it was with
Veritech Fighter.
Yeah,
with
Jetfire.
Jetfire. Yeah.
So you got Casey Jones, who is definitely rocking his abs out.
That fucking 80s crop top, bro.
And Usagi Yojimbo. You had a rock soldier that looked nothing like the rock soldier
not
from the cartoon.
Okay, so that's the ones that are coming out. Like, they're doing the...
NECA's doing them.
NECA's doing them, because yeah. I have no idea. I guess I checked out on this line pretty early, because I don't...
Yeah, because this is the second year.
I remember going in the toy store and looking like, what the hell are they? It was just so bizarre.
Like, it's wacky as fuck. Look at
like,
that.
Just imagine this shit on pegs is like so crazy. Then you had Metalhead, Rat King, Krang, Genghis Frog. And I think that was Genghis Frog anyway.
And that's Krang not in the fucking man suit. It's Krang on little legs.
Genghis Frog. Yeah, it's Krang in the little mechanical thing. Leatherhead, who looks nothing like the cartoon. He looks like more so like just like an alligator with a hat on. Baxter Stockman, who was like, I think Baxter Stockman and Casey Jones were the only two characters that I even knew when this shit came out.
Oh, I know Rat King. And
oh, maybe Rat King. But Yojimbo, I feel like, came along in the cartoon later on.
He was only in two episodes, I just read.
Oh, really?
It didn't give any explanation of why he was there, but I guess they...
There's got to be a story to that shit.
Yeah, I don't know if Mirage published both the books, maybe?
Maybe.
Let me see here.
And then
yeah,
that was...
Mirage at some point in time did publish the book. That may have been what it was.
And then Ace Duck was in it. Now, Ace Duck looked like a 1940s fighter jet pilot, and he was a duck. I'm going to tell you what it is about this that I remember. I'd never seen Ace Duck in an episode.
I can't remember.
Okay.
I remember the toy.
Yeah. So, I'd seen all these other motherfuckers in episodes. Every single one of them. And I'd never seen Ace Duck. And I was talking about it at school. And this dude, Derek, I'll never fucking forget it. Because I'm in fourth grade. And he was like, oh, I got it on tape. And I was like, can I borrow it? And he's like, no. And this was his turn. I'll never forget it. They're my priceless possessions. And I told, so I told my dad, I was like, man, I got to watch this episode. I got to be home at such and such because I want to see the Ace Duck episode. And he's like, I'm telling you, I don't think it exists. And I was like, well, he said you got it on tape. And I was like, yeah, well, I could fucking tell you anything. These fucking kids today, they fucking, you know what I mean? And I was like, man, I don't know. He seems like he's fucking legit about it. So when I was doing this, that story came to mind, and I researched it, and he is on an episode, and I don't think the years match up. I think that motherfucker was lying. I'm gonna fucking text him. I'll fucking find out. I'll track him down.
Like,
hey, let me tell you something else. And another thing, sir.
I remember a kid in school that was just. He was always lying about something. Mm-hmm. And I drew some, I think it was a Transformers, like, hey, man, have you seen this? He's like, yeah, I got that. I was like, what do you mean? He's like, I have the toy. I was like, okay. I've never seen it before. Can you bring it? He's like, I'll bring the box. I'm like, okay. Next day, saw him after school. Hey, man, did you bring that box? Yeah, hang on a sec. Oh, man, somebody stole it.
Oh, the classic.
Yeah.
So he was on the episode, but he was, like, interviewed. It was like they were watching a news show.
That's obscure, and
it was somebody like, yeah, and right here we have Ace McDuck. What are your thoughts on it? And he was like, I think it's great. And they like went back to something else. Wow. Like that was all it was.
That is a cantina move right there.
Yeah. So I don't know. I got my suspicions that dude was lying. So then you also got these wind up.
Oh my god, they're horrifying. Yes. Oh my god, that's nightmare fuel.
Did they only do three turtles?
They did three turtles.
What?
And a Mauser. And I got news for you. As this goes on, and like I said, I don't know how far we're going to get, but as this went on, you weren't guaranteed four turtles of any gimmick.
That's weird.
It's very weird. There's some where like it's just an astronaut Leonardo, but you don't get any other astronauts or whatever the case may be.
I remember when those were coming out.
But it's fucking crazy though, because they're different molds.
Yes, and
they're not just repaints.
Correct, and they're all and we're still at we're super turtle hype right now. Like you know what I mean? Like we're still riding the hype train. We're not coming down at all. But you got Michelangelo, he's sticking his tongue out, and I think they all walked was their gimmick. Donatello and Raphael, and
I am much more okay with there being one Leonardo astronaut than three and then missing one. That's so bizarre.
But I remember being excited that there was a Mauser.
Yes,
I mean that makes sense. That's actually cool that they did the Mauser.
And I wanted to troop build it, and it had like stickers all over it, like you know, like they treated it like a vehicle. But I do remember it. So then they put out two inflatable tubes. They were called the sewer tubes.
I don't remember these.
And they floated.
Bath time.
Yep, and they were for bath time or whatever, and then you could have your turtles or your villains. I think one was for turtles and one was for... I can't fucking remember. And you fucking... They hold onto their guns and they shoot each other. But, like, the thing about this that I was thinking about is, like, if you don't have the water... It's a fucking useless vehicle, you know, because like you can't get the legs through it because then it'll just be standing there like the fat kid at the pool.
So they've got holes for the legs to go through. I didn't realize.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. Okay. But like otherwise, you're just stuck.
You're just standing there with it.
Yeah. And then they came out with these three things. I don't remember any of this either. I think I remember this. It was like it was the retro catapult.
Is that a plunger at the end?
And I think these
probably.
I think these shot slime because they. Issued slime as mutagen because
I remember that.
You gotta put the slime out.
That I remember.
He-Man found a way to put the slime out.
Yep.
Did Joe's find a way to put the slime out?
Maybe in like the later years when they were fighting biopollution.
Yeah, maybe. But you had to put the slime out.
Kenner put slimes out with the aliens.
Yep. Yeah, I remember that. And I want to say there was the Ghostbusters, like the live, like the one stuff.
Yeah. Had some slime involved.
So. There was like a catapult and then like a mutagen dripping thing, which was like a torture chamber. Cause I do remember this too. And you could strap a character down there and then you like release the mutagen, like the slime on them. And it's like, no. But my dad would never support any of this shit because he'd be like, you're going to ruin them. You're going to ruin them. And I'm paying money for this shit. And we're not going to have fucking ruined toys. You're going to have slime all in the joints.
He was probably right though.
Yeah, 100%. You had the turtle cycle.
Oh my God. That is trash.
Literally.
So it's a motorcycle and it had a trash can as a sidecar, for those that remember. And this, I remember, it was sat between the handlebars of the motorcycle. It was like a little bucket on elastic spans, and it came with little weapons or little, you know, projectiles that you could put in. You,
like a slingshot.
Yep, and you slung
so
it.
So a bunch of shit that got lost immediately.
100,000%.
It's in the couch cushion still.
100,000%. You had this, which I think was Rat King's vehicle, the foot ski. But I think that, I don't know why in my head Rat King rides it. But it was like, all I remember is these tentacles. It was like a little boat and the
that
tentacles
some,
at the front
like
of it.
Cobra Law shit.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up. I got a question for you before we move on. Let's get into Joe's for a second. I got to tell you, I'm so excited you guys are here. Like, I'm having a fucking blast.
It's good different. It's very different.
It's fucking, it's alive again, I feel like.
The comment on that, you guys have social interaction through your jobs. This is the first, like, other than my family,
right, that's
I've had one instance of social interaction with work, and it was a nightmare, but this is nice.
How do you feel about Cobra Law being introduced into the classified line?
Someone asked that in one of the Joe groups, and I commented by saying something offensive, probably, but it's a travesty that Hasbro has not addressed this important part of the fiction up front. I'm fine with it either way. I'm not gonna go to change.org and sign a petition about it. But if it comes out, I'll be okay with it.
See, I only ask because I know it's a controversial,
it's a very polarizing.
Yeah. Polarizing would be a perfect word to describe it.
Yeah.
But I've always loved Cobra Law, and I know that not everybody feels that way. But the reason why I love it is
you like that chick in the skin tight suit.
I do, yeah. I do, and I like Nemesis Enforcer.
Globulus.
I could take or leave him, but he was cool. But like, it was the toy had this snake body that was weird and like always had to be like, he was like Mr. Hankey.
Yep, exactly.
But like, it made Cobra a cult. And as soon as that happened in my mind, it changed the dynamics of how I saw that organization. Because to me, they always seemed like an organization made up entirely of stormtroopers. Like literal, like rejects from any military squad that can never get anything right. And then the moment I'm like, oh, they're not a military. They're on a mission far bigger than power and money. There's world control, domination. So
I caught something that I, as a child, never caught. Mindbender, because you can go on YouTube right now and they're streaming G.I. Joe episodes. Huh. And a lot of it seems to be those five parts.
On like the Hasbro channel or something, right? Or the G.I. Joe channel.
I guess. It's just streaming constantly.
But I think it's like, because I think
it's official.
Yeah, it's official.
It's an official thing. Yeah. So sometimes when I'm just like, there's nothing else to watch right now. Fuck it. Let's put some G.I. Joe on. I end up watching a lot of the same ones, but the Arise Serpentor Arise, the five part series.
Yeah, Mindbender and Mindbender has Destro work on them together. Is that who it is?
Yeah, they have to go around and get
the blood from the fallen warriors.
Yeah. In that, Mindbender says that he had a dream explaining how the DNA worked. And then later in the movie, Globulus says, I told you to do this.
That's
to
right.
The ultimate leader. And I never like.
That's right. He does say that.
But you didn't see that back then.
Yeah.
You didn't see those seeds being planted and pulled in toy commercials.
That's fucking awesome.
It is, man. It's really cool.
I love that the creators during that time, that their heart was in it. Like the paycheck wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
The glitz and glam wasn't there. And it was goofy. And it was to sell a toy. And they all knew it. But they still put real heart into it. You know, like they cared.
Yeah.
Masters of the Universe, Transformers, yeah. G.I. Joe, they all gave a fuck.
Yeah, at least for the first three seasons.
Correct, until the movies.
Yeah,
the pizza thrower.
I remember that.
Yeah. So I remember this as well. And it was a giant tank, and there was a dispenser at the top where you stacked in pizzas. As it rolled, there was a mechanical device that shot the pizzas out of the front thing. Look, I'm gonna tell you something. If the Turtles are defeating the Foot Clan by throwing large pizzas at them, sign me up, Joseph, for a bit of Foot Clan.
That would distract the fuck out of me if someone threw a large pizza at me.
Yeah, I'd be like,
I'll fight later, man.
It's kind of like what Robin Williams said about the Taliban. Just send them peanut butter. Just shit they've never seen before.
Oh.
So this was fucking cool.
Yeah, that's the actually cool vehicle.
It was the Foot Cruiser.
Yep.
I'm
pimped out.
But it actually was in the cartoon. Like, but like the Foot didn't use it. It was like the Neutrinos used it.
It's a sweet paint job.
Yeah, yeah, it is. My wife is so funny. She's running into GameStop. Anything you're looking for? I'm like, dude, what are you in the game
pimp,
now?
Pimp Daddy Destro.
Sounds like your mom or a mom.
Yeah.
Want anything in the store?
Oh, so anyway, but that like the so like I remember buying this. I had this, but it was like the neutrinos and shit that I put in it, not the
Who are the neutrinos? I don't know.
So they went to this other,
makes me think about hamsters. I don't know why.
So they went to this other dimension. I can't remember if there was Dimension X or not. I need to watch the cartoon again. But they went to this other dimension, and in that dimension was the rock soldiers were from mm-hmm. Dimension X. Then there was the Triceratons.
Yes.
I remember the Triceratons.
Yeah. And I can't remember whether they were from Dimension X or not. But then I think the Neutrinos were from there as well. And they were like,
I remember the Neutrinos.
So they were kind of like,
we're gonna get to them here?
I'm sure.
Okay.
They were kind of like cool guys, like cool 80s guys. They had like glasses that came out at an angle to the side.
Okay,
like,
okay. I remember seeing it.
Yeah, hair was very wispy at the top. Like that guy that sold Coca-Cola that was what was his fucking name? The guy that fucking sold Coca-Cola that was a computer face. Yeah.
Oh, Max Headroom.
Yeah. They kind of look like him, but younger. And then there was Fugitoid. Now, some of that, what's interesting about that is that some of that shit was pulled from the comics. Like, Triceratons and all that shit was, like, from this other dimension. Like, I don't even think Krang and shit was in the comics.
They were not.
So, like, it was just interesting, this, like, collage of shit between the comics and the cartoon, the toys, and the live-action movie all started to kind of blend together.
And the Archie comics.
So that I don't know about.
Yeah, so Archie did a cartoon comic book. I mean, it was stuff from the unless I'm completely
I just don't know.
Remembering this. I'm pretty sure that Archie Publishing did a Ninja Turtles.
Huh.
Let me double check.
I don't know.
I'm doubting myself now.
And I'm far from a Ninja Turtle expert.
That dude.
So, the sewer place. So I had it. I had it, and it was fucking badass. It would be in my like conversation of greatest play sets of all time. So there was the pipe that, so to speak, that went down into the lower section, and you could like drop a turtle down like it was a sliding board down into the play set. Like it would come down here and then pop out into this box. There was a hydrant that was also like a periscope.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was the turtle bed, like that was cut into like a sewer hole. And then there was also this little yellow bomb here that you could drop down the pipe as well. And then like the up here on the street, because it was like a two layer playset, and on the street was where you could like fight the crime and shit, you know. And of course the bad guys would get into the lower quadrants as well. But
Archie Comics published in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Adventures from 88 to 95.
Oh, there you go.
It was separate from all the other stories, but it was more of a cartoonish
and I wonder how much of that was getting pulled, because it definitely seemed like the creative people at the time were like, oh, we'll take a little bit from this, we'll take a little bit from this, we'll borrow from this. Because like the movies heavily influenced on the cartoon and the comics, the first live action. And then the toys ended up making Toka and Rezar part of their line. Right. They were even in the cartoon, Toka and Rezar eventually. So like they did, they really kind of, it's like there was definitely some communication and cooperation between all of the different creative people that were working on Turtles at the time, which I do find interesting as like looking back through it.
It's such a fucking hodgepodge of stuff. Oh, these I remember.
So this was the first theme.
Yep.
Of this was in 1990. This is the first time that we get like the thematic turtle line where you get four new turtles. Now, what's interesting to think about, this is 1990. The line releases in 88, right? Since then, you don't get four turtles again for 2 years.
That's crazy. That's not something I thought about.
So, like, either they kept them in production and just kept running the four turtles over and over and over and over and over again, so that each wave might come. You know what I mean?
That would make sense, because they don't need to change anything,
right?
And like until the Arctic Batman shit.
right.
Yeah.
So this is our first hint of that, and it was Donatello, and he was in like a kind of the disguise that we see Raphael in the live action. It was Leonardo in a samurai outfit. Was Michelangelo.
I really wanted that.
It was Michelangelo as like a surfer dude. With like flippers on and shit, and Raphael as a astronaut.
I always hated their faces when they did the mouths on the side.
Yeah, I always made that face. Like, how do you do that?
Yeah, I used to make that face too. Yeah. Like, especially when they did it on both sides.
Yeah. How do you do that? Put some toothpicks between my teeth.
I mean, they definitely got Donatello and Raphael's role reversed. Donatello should definitely be in a space.
Oh, 100%. If shit like that makes me wonder, like, is that a legit mistake? Do you know what I mean? Because like it seems like such an obvious like Michelangelo's the surfer dude.
Yep, makes sense.
It was probably like, hey, which one's the blue one again? I don't know.
You said Rembrandt.
Picasso? They don't have ears.
It was interesting that like I thought like for 2 years you didn't get another set of four turtles and the wacky shit so on the other side of that it only took 2 years for the wacky shit to get started.
Yeah,
you know,
but there's only so many ways you can do the same character, right?
correct. So also in 1990 is when the toys start getting wacky also.
I mean, like they were regular, wacky already, but like this shit,
the regular line.
I remember I don't know what this guy's name, the purple guy with the yellow fucking tentacle hair, but he stands out to me.
Yeah, so I can't. Let's see. His name has got to be down here somewhere.
I think
that toy is very fucking.
So I think that's Wingnut and Screwloose.
I think around this time, like from what I'm not a Turtles expert either. I'm sure there's somebody that can tell us more, but I think some of these started to become like now they're the hard ones to find.
It may have very well been. So like, I can tell you that like I remember I still vividly remember these waves, and this year we've increased the amount of figures they're releasing almost by a third. But you get the Angry Pizza Man, I forget what his name was. I'm sure it's on here somewhere. Pizza Face.
Surprise. Man.
You get Muck Man, who they're doing NECA's doing.
Okay.
You get that was Wingnut. That was Wingnut and Screwloose because he was like a bat and he had like a little friend. I remember him in the cartoon. He had Mutagen Man, who was like a body filled with water that had like bits in it, like little.
I always thought that was gross.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's great because it's so gross.
It had like human bits and like as you moved him around, like the bits are like floating through the water. Like,
love it. I mean, that's like really creative for a toy.
Yeah, man, it's fucking cool. And then they had this mosquito guy who I always. I'm trying to find what his name was because I always used to put him with Scumbag.
How many of these out of this line, this set, did you have, Bobby?
Every single one.
Wow,
I had every single one.
Yeah, fucking Kung Fu Panda before Kung Fu Panda was a thing.
So that's a fact. And his name was Samurai Panda, Panda Khan. That's a fucking cool name too. There's a lot of them got cool names, like at least funny. Mondo Gecko.
Yep.
NECA's doing him now as well. That's Fugitoid. That was from the comics, and I don't think was in the cartoon at that point.
Yeah, no.
Triceraton, which was from the comics and not in the cartoon, I think by this point as well. And then Ray Fillet, who's kind of become like the...
I love that name.
Yeah, he's kind of become like the Arctic Batman of that Turtles line. Like, when people talk about the Turtles line, like, yeah, man, it was really cool. You get into, like, Ray Fillet and shit. You know, like... But if you think about it, it's not really fair to Ray Fillet, because they're still kind of killing it at this point. And they're not overdoing the turtles. They're not overdoing.
So there's a Donatello there.
So
does he do?
So that was the storage shell Donatello, where he opened up and you could store all of his accessories inside of his body.
Kind of creepy if you think about it.
Did they end up doing all the turtles like that?
I think so, but I can't remember for sure. And you got Slash, who to this day is
Slash.
Way cooler than the cartoon version. Way fucking cooler. And I can tell you that the Slash had two different paint jobs. And the only reason why I know this is because my brother had them. And this is fucked up. I took my Slash over there. And my Slash, like, you see how his Slash is like a, we're looking at this picture, it has like a darker yellow here.
Mm-hmm. Like the chest?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mine had like a canary yellow chest.
Hmm.
And like his was just painted better. It just had like, it just looked like a darker scheme, like the whole thing. So I brought mine over and I swapped it.
Oh my God.
Because I visited him on the weekends. So like I'd hang out at the weekend, I'm like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And then I swapped Slashes. And my brother snitched on me and told my mom. And then I was telling my mom, like, no, I don't know what the fuck he's talking about. Like, I don't, you know, lied through my fucking teeth. But I, that's, I mean, that's the, when I got rid of my Turtles collection, his slash is the one I got rid of. He kept my, you know what I mean? I never gave it back.
Nice.
Older brother swag. But yeah, like, it's still like you have a whole wave, you're only getting one fucking turtle, and everything's a unique sculpt. And then there was this other frog who was, I'm trying to find a name. Napoleon Bonafrog.
Wow.
What a mess. What a mess.
So I think he was in the cartoon too, because there was a they encountered like this team of frogs that was like four brothers, and they all were like a crew also at some point, and like Genghis Frog was one of them, and I think Napoleon Bonafrog was one of them, but they didn't look anything like this. They looked like friendly frogs.
Battletoad.
Yeah, which was a straight ripoff. And then there was this shit, which I don't remember these really at all. They were wacky action, and they included this is the figures from the first assortment. It was Leonardo, Splinter, and Shredder. They're fucking terrifying looking, and they had some sort of wind-up action, obviously. And
was this the second time we get a different Shredder and
yep,
whatever that and Splinter is?
And Splinter. So theoretically, like if they didn't re-release, and I don't think they re-released Splinter, because I remember Splinter being hard to find. Like, I remember not seeing him all the time. And I want to say that, like, that they probably didn't re-release that Splinter. So, like, you would have been ass out, you know, as, like, a young person getting into this shit. It's like certain things that, like, I feel like they take into effect now that they never fucking even considered back then. I don't remember this at all.
No, not at all.
Ninja Pizza is a wacky weapon thing. It had like,
it looks like a fucking knock it down or
crazy
something.
Johnny, yeah, I'm guessing. Yeah.
That looks like a Johnny Five.
It does look like a Johnny Five on wheels. It looks like almost like a what do they call those things that like people ride around in DC?
Oh, Segway.
Segway. Yeah. And this shit, I don't remember at all. Sludge Mobile and the toilet, the toilot taxi.
Those are awful.
I feel like they're like either reaching or like they're high. They're just fucking hodgepodge of colors and parts.
So the toilet taxi was like a toilet on wheels to make it look like a dune buggy kind of, with a plunger weapon at the front and like pipes to a shower that looks like where the exhaust would go from the back.
It looks like a combination of an ATV and grandma's scooter.
Yes. Yes, it does.
The other one's just a disaster. I can't even explain that.
So are these.
Wait, what?
So these are the pizza powered vehicles.
Oh, that's three different things. It just looks like one big mess of parts.
I think
there.
It's only two. Is it? but okay. I agree. It's like it's
a mess of parts.
I'll be honest. I thought it was like, oh, the stuff from before can combine. That's what I thought it was.
The Psycho Cycle and the Sewer Dragster. I don't remember these at all. They were like motorcycles, one for a good guy, one for a bad guy.
I remember these. These are fucking also fucking scary.
Mega Mutants. There was Killer Bee and Needle Nose, and they were like riding things. And what's funny is I must not even known about these, because I would have been in on this, because it would have been a vehicle and a character. And I was much more into characters than I was into vehicles. You know, which is funny, because like even in hindsight, looking at and thinking about like Star Wars and G.I. Joe, both that relied heavily on their vehicle assortment, I kind of had some, but I didn't care as much, and people would gift them to me.
Yeah.
But I would like they often ended up in a bin, mm-hmm, where the figures ended up on the floor. Mm. For me.
Yeah. Just thinking about it. I had a ton.
I think I'm the exception to the rule. I think most kids love the fucking vehicles and shit.
I played with the figures a lot more, but I especially the Jets. I always loved all the Jets. Mm. You know, Benny and the Jets.
Sure.
I remember
West Side Story.
Exactly. I had the Aw Striker, the F-16, mm-hmm, that had the swoop wings, yeah, and moving anywhere. I remember having that, and my cousin came over to visit, and he was a small little kid. And I remember him grabbing it by the wings and just slamming it. He was one of those kids that just broke everything, just slamming it into the ground. And I'm like, what are you doing?
You didn't sock him?
Rock him, sock him?
Well, how he turned out, I probably should have.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I was talking about earlier, like, knowing how to navigate life. He didn't get his fucking consequences, and he turned out fucked up.
This is the Turtle Copter. I have zero recollection of this whatsoever.
Who was on fucking shrooms designing these vehicles? They are fucking crazy.
They're wild.
You can't wrap your brain around this shit.
It looks like a turtle shell that has been transformed into a helicopter that has a giant turtle hand hanging out of the side of it, with three mosquito weapons connected to it and two boxing glove weapons.
And a turtle mouth in the front.
And it looks like the snakes tied together are the blades.
Yep. Is that a screaming frog right as an engine?
I think so. Or a leech.
Jesus Christ.
If your kid drew this at school, you get a call from the teacher.
You're getting a call. This is a lot of that like Toxic Avenger kind of shit. Yes, that, you know,
it's got that side turtle mouth. The fucked up double
teeth. Yeah. But like it gets like some of this shit just got like it was like oh.
This is more normal.
So the mutant module. So it's this like was cool. I never had this. But this was cool because this was in the cartoon. This is how they got around from the Technodrome.
I don't remember this.
Man, it's not bizarre.
I don't remember it either.
I think
I do remember the toy, but I never had it. But like, yeah, and it makes sense. And it's like the Technodrome was underground, so they would send these things out. They'd bore through the fucking, you know, underground subterranean levels and then come out on the street or come out in the whatever. But yeah, that was cool. And then lastly, the last one that we're going to talk about today.
Yeah, that shit is...
Was the Technodrome?
I wonder what retail. I'm gonna look up what retail was
or
on
eBay. Oh yeah, look up retail, and I'll look up eBay because I wonder what a Technodrome because this was a rare thing back then, as far as I remember, because I think it took up a lot of shelf space in the box and like not a lot of places carried it. But it was super. It was like you know in comparison to the rest of the fucking line, it was super cartoon accurate and like had like a ton of fucking gimmicks.
Yeah, there's a lot of shit inside.
Like, it had, you know, periscope inside. It had multiple levels. Had a jail cell, of course. Like, it had a bridge that could connect between, because the whole shell opened up. Like, it was fucking cool. TMNT Technodrome on eBay is what I'm looking up.
So, and I want you guys to guess what the retail was on that.
$50.
Yeah, same.
$50.
Yeah.
Which, that was a Christmas gift, right?
Yeah.
Or birthday.
For sure. So right now you can get buy it now the Technodrome for $60 plus $20 shipping. So let me ask you this: that's it for today. That is 88 through 90. And the next time we do one of these, we'll cover another 2 years.
Or maybe you find my fucking smoke bomb plane.
Maybe. So let me ask you this question to the listeners mainly: how does it feel that the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Technodrome has held its value more than most of your third party products?
Wow.
And your Takara Seekers, you cocksuckers. we have a couple questions to tackle real quick.
I do want to follow up on something from last week.
Sure.
The John Wick figure.
Okay.
By the time I got it, the scuttlebutt about it, I was like, I don't even care anymore. It was kind of heartbreaking for me because I was so excited to get it.
I think you did mention something about that.
Yeah.
Or maybe you just talked about it in the car with me when we
yeah,
went out.
Yeah, yeah.
We forgot to mention that.
Yeah, Bobby and I went on a fruitless toy hunt.
Fruitless toy hunt. But yeah, I think there's truth to that when something is coming and everybody shits on it before you get
and
it.
And I got it late. I mean, it seemed like it had been a month, but it had only been like 2 weeks. But it was such a hard stance everybody took on it. You know, it's fine. I opened it. I had gotten some stuff already together and made a custom different suit one, but I haven't taken any time with it. I just like, maybe I'll come back around to it, but it's I don't know.
And
I'm disappointed in myself for not being more excited because it's really well done. It's not perfect,
but it does put it, there is. I mean, yes, I agree with you. And I looking at it outside opinion, I'm like, this doesn't look good. Like, you know, I would think to myself, I would be disappointed if this was how it looked. But I don't have a dog in the fight. And more important,
John Wick joke.
But more importantly, man, like the amount of there is a conversation there too. I need somebody that wants to be a Nerd Rage assistant that wants to write down all the conversations that we're supposed to have at some point and also wants to keep track of conversations that we can reference specific episodes about. Getting a product after the world has shitted on it and it taking the fuel out of the vehicle, you know, before you even get a chance to make a fucking decision on it.
Right.
You know, it's definitely happened to me with third party stuff, you know, like, oh, it's a piece of shit. Everybody knows it's a piece of shit. And like now,
look at it, it's hard to look at it. objectively
with a clean slate
without having these sideways opinions on it.
I agree. But yeah, we did get a a question from Paul C., who said, this week's questions are going to be back to the good old porn well. Back in the day, porn was all about the professional videos with good or bad production value. Now it's all about amateur porn, and if not true amateur stuff, it's about studio-made content that is designed to seem amateur. Why do you think this has all changed? I haven't noticed. I don't know that. I may not be on the cutting edge of... I feel like porn today is now like there's no story, and there's just like scene...
No, this is a variety of porn. It's just not... You're not into it enough. Like if you want to look like, because there's all the porn ever you ever want that is made, like whatever right. you want to look for is there. So it's you, it might not be in the front page of Pornhub or Xvideos or whatever, but it's there. It's mm-hmm. Because there are like 2-hour feature length movies up with story that is a porn for sure.
Right.
But with, I mean, literally, if we wanted to right now make a porno, we could do it right here and have it on,
that's why,
on so Pornhub in an hour, I'm assuming.
Well,
right?
And after Pornhub, you can, it's like Twitch. You can yeah. be a verified user where like you just upload your own videos and people pay you. So,
but I just feel like I feel like there's still plenty of, like, I still see like in feeds and stuff. On other people's phones, not mine. There's definitely certain brand brazers and whatever that are making studio yes. quality.
Yeah. No, I think it's just the it seems like the amateur is dominating just because of the quantity, because there are so many people, like normal normal people, average people just uploading fucking porn
videos.
Videos.
You probably nailed it. Probably nailed it right there. It's YouTube.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
For every professional company that's working on the YouTube platform with like, you know, light people and sound people, there's 10 billion me's.
Yep.
Yeah. I'll say that during this crisis we've been in.
COVID crisis?
The couple that has their account on YouTube, or not YouTube, Pornhub, is probably done pretty well mm-hmm. compared to the studios that probably can't get two people together that aren't going to.
Yeah, man, I tell you that, like, getting equipment, with shit ton of equipment for streaming now, like fucking 5 or 6 cameras and a few mics, but like it's hard. Like if you want to look for a camera to buy now, it's hard. If you want to look for a mic, like anything you do indoors, it's hard to find. Trampoline, it was like a three month wait for a trampoline 3 months ago. You can't buy gym equipment. Like, oh, yeah, everything like, is sold out everywhere.
Dumbbells are like $15 a pound now.
Freezer. A freezer is hard to get.
Oh, because everyone's
like a deep freeze.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we kind of.
I got one.
We kind of regretted giving that to Joe.
Too bad we use it.
Yeah, I've been thinking about leasing space in yours as we head back into cold and flu season.
Yeah.
Okay, and then he had another question in there too, which was further step porn.
Yeah, yeah. Stepmom, stepdad.
Okay. Is one of the most popular porn genres at the moment. To what do you attribute the shift in preference? Was there a societal shift that suddenly made everyone want to sleep with their stepsister or stepmother?
I think it's just more okay now, because
I think it's a taboo thing. I think a lot of videos just get titled that for.
No, that's definitely like we're talking about the production value. Like the things are being produced specifically to be. You call them stepbrothers and shit in the fucking video. I think maybe because the way our society now, there is a lot of step siblings out there, and dudes want to bang the stepsisters.
That might be true. That might be a good point. But I also think it's about, like, you know, how far can you push the limits of, you know, edge. You know, like at what point do they just say, "Yeah, it's my sister." You know, like,
I mean, like, because banging your stepsister is not that taboo to me. I don't think it's just a chick that you attach a name to.
I remember,
depends on how old you are when you became step siblings. If your fucking parents just got together,
no, that's true. That's, you know, no, it's still taboo either way. I feel like, but I hear you. I definitely feel you on that. I definitely
you didn't grow up together,
right? If you could be like, my dad, I'm fucking 40. My dad just remarried and.
Exactly.
Yeah, or what about when you've had this, you know, side piece and. Your dad gets married to her mom, and
mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, we're not going to change anything, you know.
Yep. Yeah,
it's like Elkridge. I hear a lot of people.
Know. Oh gosh,
they say that the Elkridge family tree is more like a stump.
Hey man, this tree ain't got no branches.
Okay, so
roots run deep though.
Then we got another question from BD Wood. He said
that sounds like a porn name.
Big Dick Wood. He said, "What's up, guys? This may be a touchy subject, for some, but I've noticed a lot of complaints recently on prices in general. I understood recent figures selling out and poor distribution causing issues, but in terms of late tax and the recent increase of shipping prices, people passing up on figures they want due to the increase. I would like to know you guys' opinions on a price, on if a price increase keeps you from getting the products you want, if continuing a collection is really the best option, if that's a big, if it's that big of a burden. We all have a certain amount of disposable income, but when does collecting become irresponsible?
Let me crack my knuckles on this one.
Yeah, I know you want to dig in. Let me buffer that real quick, because I know we're all in agreement on this. we're only going to approach this from the idea of price increase for things that we want. All of us agree that when you start adding the word irresponsible in, that toys go out the fucking window. You mm-hmm. pay your bills, you take care of your family, you do all the things you're supposed to do first, and then everything else comes second. With that being said, get them.
So I know my wife listens. I mean, everything I get's $40. Nothing's ever.
right.
I'm kidding. So just to make sure I'm clear, are we talking about secondary markets? Or are we talking about retailers increasing their prices?
I think it's about. I think it's more about retailers, secondary market on current things, and manufacturers and company increase.
I'll start here. I can tie this back to the sneaker community. So at one point in time, every Air Jordan release that came out was sold out immediately and doubled in price automatically. Mm. Jordan increased their buy-in. Their price went basically from $150 to $200. And the secondary market plummeted because people were less interested in spending that extra money mm-hmm. for that flip. Mezco, I don't know if they're trying to control the secondary market, but everything they've put out lately has been a bundle. So you get a t-shirt and a pin and a this, that, and the other, and it's $150 instead of $80. Mm-hmm. Secondary market has honestly reacted pretty much the same. Stuff doesn't go up as much, but there's still a serious increase in value. Now, secondary market, if you miss out on something, you're going to have to pay to get it.
Yeah.
You know, like there's so much people, a thing of hating groups is, decent price. Yo, who's got...
Fan price, bro.
Who's got this for a decent price, right? And you can go back, and there's a couple friends I have in some of these groups that will say, yep, we'll come back in 3 months when this is out. And, you know, this guy is, oh, I'd never buy that. That's a piece of shit. I'd never buy it. 3 months later, anybody got so-and-so at a decent price? I caught a guy like that the other day on something, and it was on the John Wick. He's like, I'm canceling my wait list. This figure's awful. Got the figure. Oh, you know, I got it in hand. It's not that bad. I went back, grabbed his screenshot, and I said, how about them apples? And he's like, oh, well, I canceled my wait list, but not my actual order. I'm like, well, you sure didn't address it like that in this salty-ass conversation? He blocked me. But of course.
Well, like, I think that there's – we're talking about – I agree with you. Like, get in on the pre-order, pay for the fucking thing you want, mm-hmm. and then if you don't, then you have to deal with the consequences of your decision. Right. However, shit like the G.I. Joe stuff as of late, the NECA stuff is changing that dynamic where like now I don't even feel like I have the opportunity to get what I want, and I want to get it. So if something comes out, for instance, this April came out today, I'm going to go ahead and check to see if it's available now while we're talking about it. But this April came out today or supposed to drop today and it'll be sold out. It's not at our store, right? My wife just went there. It's not there. And I don't have a way to pre-order it. Mm-hmm. So, like, you're not creating the supply for the demand. That's an issue I have with kind of some of the stuff that's going on in the toy world today. Black Series, G.I. Joe, and NECA Turtles.
Is this the two-pack? Comes with a foot soldier? Okay.
Interestingly enough, the Marvel Legends are not really having that problem. They are meeting demand. It seems like they have the about the appropriate amount of supply, because like I don't hear people saying they can't find certain figures. And at the same time, there's like two or three, four or five figures left on the pegs, but it's not a fucking ghost town.
Mm-hmm. But you could also, like the announcing of Spider-Man wave, you could go immediately and pre-order
to a number of different places mm-hmm. and pre-order it. And the same for what? But
is there a price point difference between these lines?
No. No, not so, between not what with NECA. There's like a $3 price difference.
So NECA's okay. selling two packs for $50, except some of the bigger ones are more expensive. But I mean,
everything else is about $22.
Yeah. So this is today. It's going for double retail
already.
The two packs
dropped today.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, so like I do have an issue with that.
I mean, that's part of it's double sided problem. It's a problem of supplier not supplying enough, and but it's also on the consumer side. If you people out there keeps buying shit for double the price,
exactly.
it will continue to happen. It's a supply and demand thing. There's no decency. It's fucking money. What is it worth to you? If you're buying for double price, even if you're complaining about it, you found it worthwhile to spend double the money.
Well, let's look at it this way. Let's say you want a Cobra Trooper. It's a $20 figure at Target.
Yeah.
All day long, right? I haven't looked today, but in the past week, they've been $65 to $70 a piece on eBay. All right? So let's say you're going to drive around for a week, going to Targets, having to interact, which a lot of people that collect toys don't want to do,
and,
with Target employees.
And put yourself at risk.
And put yourself at risk, or just pay an extra $40 and have it at your house.
But to me, it's a principality thing. I know. You know, I won't do it. Not at that price. Like,
what percentage are you okay with paying over retail for something that just came out that you can't find?
No, I'm a hunt.
Okay,
I'm a hunt. And now, when we get started, like now the next wave is here. All right. Well, now let me see what I got to do.
Well,
here.
Bobby, I mean the turtle stuff. You've got lots of.
I'm fortunate.
Hang on. You've got lots of foot soldiers. Let me get the honk.
I'm fortunate to have a lot of people and have access to a lot of people.
Right.
You know, so like I'm definitely appreciative of it. I don't take it for granted. But I still feel like there's some stuff that like I'm not necessarily in the world of that I just wouldn't pay. I don't think I could do any. I think double would be my limit.
Okay.
For something that's right in today. Now, the other thing I think that he's talking about in here is also raising prices, like things like you know, Black Series have jumped from $19.99 to $22. You know, Fans Toys, we've seen like a $10 to $15 markup pretty much on everything across the board on their initial batch. But like, so some of that stuff, I'm like, the world is different now. It probably costs more to produce more now. I
mean, price increase is just
price increase is also part of the dynamics of the globe, and also with Fans Toy specifically being the only one in that pocket that I feel like the price jump is a little bit more significant. I'm a defender. Let me just get that out of the way. They don't have any competition anymore.
Yep.
They've killed the competition.
They don't have competition, and also they know people are going to buy it no matter what.
Exactly.
If they wanted to charge $250 for that beachcomber that you reviewed,
I got to get it. That's the rules.
Them the rules.
I'll complain about it, but I'm going to buy it. Mm-hmm. So like,
if you don't, it'll be $500 the next week.
That, and nobody else is making one. Mm-hmm. You know, because nobody else is.
I think that's the difference where I've changed. Like, I mean, I love this shit. I'm still a collector at heart, but like, it's not as important to me to have something anymore. Like, it's not always going to be like for you. Like, no one else is going to make it. I have to have it. It doesn't matter the price. For me, it's like, there's no hard and fast rule. Like, I'll pay up to certain markup. It depends on who the character is, how much I want it.
What it means.
How much I'm willing to pay for it. But like, there is a stopping point where like, it's just not fucking worth it.
And I'm probably in the same boat. I'm ultimately at the end of the day.
Yeah. I mean, we all have it. It's $1,000. You're going to stop. But like,
right.
I think for me, like it stops a lot sooner than some other like more hardcore, I guess, collector.
So like, I'll give you. So sometimes I will put a cap on priority. So like, I'm riding this. Thank you. Would you mind putting it on the couch? Thank you so much. I'm riding this turtle wave right now. Right. I'm really enjoying the nostalgia of it at the moment. So I was looking into some of the Super 7 stuff because I was like, man, I might supplement some of this stuff with Super 7 if it fits right or whatever. And I was looking at theirs and I was like, Mutagen Man for $45, that's not worth that to me.
Right.
You know, and like, even though I kind of want it, I am at a point where I'm like, I don't see the value of the asking price in this product. Therefore, I'm out. You have outpriced my interest.
That's fair.
You know?
Yeah, and I have zero interest in paying over market value for on the fucking week that something comes out. I'm not doing it.
So right. So let's say it's a SDCC exclusive or whatever. and you missed, you overslept and you blew it.
Exclusives are different.
Well, let's talk about that.
Than let's regular store release.
Let's say if whether you want this black and red Cobra Commander.
Mm-hmm.
It comes out on Pulse. It's a clusterfuck shit show. Who knows who actually gets these things because nobody was able to check out.
Right.
But, you know, they're on eBay for $30 a double retail or $20 more. Depends on what you if you want, how bad you want it, I guess.
So exclusives for me is a case-by-case thing. Those NECA... Oh, God, it makes me want to vomit fucking saying it. Those NECA Turtles in Time boxes, I can see them. I can see one of them glaring at me from here.
SDCC box sets.
Yep. I bought both of them mm-hmm. for double retail. So
that wasn't uncommon at the time.
And that was $400 purchase.
That wasn't uncommon at the time. People were paying that much for it.
That hurt. It still hurts. I
mean, and you wanted it that bad at that time.
Yep. But it's also an exclusive. So like I didn't pay for the plane ticket. I didn't stand in line early anymore. Yeah. So like they're those sorts of things I will take into consideration. And but like if you drove 15 minutes down the street to Walmart, I'm not paying you triple retail on eBay for fucking, you know, I'm not going to do it.
And exclusive nowadays is different than like 10, 15 years ago anyway. Before, it was like you have to get a secondary market. But now it's exclusive. You can pre-order exclusives on BBTS.
Well, not only that, but like every single one of those fucking Turtles came out retail.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Every fucking Marvel... I'm getting mad. Every fucking Marvel Legend SDCC box set exclusive that I bought... has come out in retail for the most, well, every like big character from it. So like, I think about like that Abominus wave. Enchantress came out, Abomination came out, the Spider-Man came out, like, so, but like Absorbing Man, I think was in that. He came out, like, I think, I could be wrong, but.
Was that the Raft one?
Yes.
Well, Purple Man never came out.
Purple Man never came out.
He's
so
super obscure though.
So here's another thing. The Hela mm-hmm. from the Doctor Strange box set never came out, and that's the one I want. So like that's my luck, you know. Yeah. So when something exclusive comes out, I usually throw the dice and lose, but fuck it. But like, yeah, I do feel like the exclusive market is a little bit different because I acknowledge what people did to do that. Mm-hmm. Like you know, like if you went to NYCC and you're helping Mezco set up and you're doing, you're taking time like this, there's things there. Like if somebody wanted an exclusive, myself included, and you're like, look, man, you mind, I would, or like, how about I buy you lunch, you know, or, but like, you know, same for anybody else anywhere. But like the shit when it's like fucking supposed to be released at Target in a fucking box that's cut open with a box cutter and some dude named fucking Aiden is fucking putting the fucking things on the shelves. Like, I'm supposed to be able to walk in there as a customer and take it off the shelf and put it in my cart and go take it to the register and buy it because that's how fucking retail works.
Yes. It's normal ass retail.
Side note, mm-hmm. I was in Target this morning, got that Baroness, and the two kids that were stocking were having a conversation about power levels of Pokemon.
Fuck yeah.
Sounds about right.
It's good.
I was like, oh. Okay. That's one of them was the kid that told me that the Hasbro rep has to come put the figures on the pegs. I'm like, no, dude. Then he said it was Nesca. Nesca?
Nesco.
Nesca?
Nesco 112.
Nesca.
Yeah. I think it's also different for me because the stuff I collect is that's not an issue. Like I collect statues, so I have to either order them, pre-order them, or get them secondary market. And secondary markup is still not that much. If you can find, if someone's selling their shit, it's not much more. It's not like double fucking statue value.
Right.
And, and you don't have people scalping statues.
But they do have exclusive statues, and they do have in like the third party statue world.
Mm-hmm. And you get it or you don't.
That's a different ball game.
Yeah. You have to know whether you want it.
I'm just finding out. So the same way I felt when I found Rain Man,
mm-hmm.
I'm feeling now again in regards to these third party statues.
I don't guess I'm plugged in.
It's a different world.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of sites carry them.
Yep.
In secret ways.
Yep.
They call them artist proofs or how are they?
Sometimes they have whole secret sites within the site.
Yep. Like you got it. You find this. They're like, oh, you're looking for that? Could you enter in your special login for that?
Yep.
Like there's a whole world out mm-hmm. there.
Wow.
And and sometimes they're like 200 pieces and that's it. Gone forever.
Yeah. There's an Ahsoka that's fucking amazing.
That's you're coming to my world, Bobby.
But it's gone. and it was an independent guy who did it, and he made a couple hundred of them, I think, and they're going for $2,000.
And you can't make more because
the lightsabers light up.
The mode only lasts so long. When you're doing it at the garage by yourself, literally, you're not trying to fucking just limit yourself to 200 pieces. The mold breaks down and you can't fucking do anymore.
Right.
And that's the problem.
Anyway, I think we can wrap up.
Good shit, guys.
This feels good. All right. With that being said, shout out to the Cool Table, Shattercast Uncut, End of the Realm, Toy Detox, Stasis Lock, Building Up to It, Breaking the Mold, Fresh Communications, and Verbally Challenged. And shout out to the rest of the Cool Table. I mean, the rest of the Nerve Rage team. Dante the Destroyer, who has Off the Mats podcast. Also, Raul on our Instagram, and Marilyn Phil, who texted me and said, "Are you going to publish an episode today?" Because like he's waiting to tweet it out. Manny.
Thursday.
I did talk to Manny. Manny's in good health.
Good.
He's fine.
Good to hear.
That was. I'd love to hear it. Shout out to Gort. It's his birthday. Let's make some noise for them.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Gort.
And Andy helped me with the Force stuff. Tyler too as well. And there was somebody else. Oh, Dunkel. Shout out to Dunkel. He's got a podcast that he started with his wife called Shaded Corner. So check that out too if you get a second. I'll tell you, I'm very happy to be back. Feels good. And I'm ready to say goodbye, Joe. You go ahead.
Flappy labias.
Tasty taint.
Tight dick player.